From KX News in high definition, this is a special report, Flood Fight 2011.
And good morning. It is 12 minutes past the hour of 1 o'clock. Tom Schrader and I'm Shaun Sipma in with you as our continuing coverage rolls on through the early morning hours. Along with us is Mike Heilman, and we've got a few other people in around
Piper
the office.
Piper Jones, Stephanie Waldroff, Bob Berger.
Bob Berger, sure. Eric Manlove.
Eric Manlove, he's out shooting something right now.
I think he's actually venturing down along that 16th Street Bridge right now. We wanted to get an update on exactly just how close that water is, because the river has gone up again as we're edging closer to that 1555 mark. It's at 1554.95, I believe the screen right above your head there with that latest reading.
And now before we, did it go up again? Do I need to change it again?
95? No, I think 1554.95.
Okay. Before we get off the cleanup, should there be sewage backup? Kevin sent us this. It says something else to think about. A good pair of hiking boots, a good pair of gloves, and a lot of help from your friends. But, I mean, when you think about it, I mean, gloves, sure. Boots, because you're going to be walking in it. Mm-hmm. So, and that's not going to happen everywhere.
No.
But we're getting pretty strong indications that it's going to happen somewhere.
The other question that was posed earlier, that County Road 6 east of West Hope, that is still open, and that was as of midnight tonight, so it still has 1 foot to go. Not to say that it won't be closed at some time, depending on what those flows are that are coming down from Canada at a tremendous amount that will reach past that 27,000 CFS. That very well could be closed, but as of right now, County Road 6 just east of West Hope, that's coming from Mr. Schrader. We appreciate that that update there. One other issue here, and I was going to page through it, and I see it's already gone past down the line there. We talked about the North Central Research Extension Center opening up to animals. Sterling Kennels still has openings, and they're willing to take in some of these animals from the evacuated areas. What they're asking for, though, is a shot record, and I think that it might even be good to include when we take anything up to the research center as well, any kind of paperwork you have for your animals. And Sterling Kennels will be opening up as well as at 8 a.m. This morning, and then they will be closing their doors up at 7 p.m. And of course, you're also, you know, asked to maybe call ahead at 852-6379. Again, 852-6379. Sterling Kennels, if for some reason you missed that phone book, they're also in the phone book.
So, you know, something that you touched on here that kind of gets me into another little area, paperwork. You know, and I would hope that people that are have the mandatory evacuation order were past, you know, filing paperwork. I mean, we should be farther along than that, I would hope. But obviously some people have worked late, they couldn't get babysitters, and they're still packing tonight. But shot records, things like that, prescriptions.
Birth certificates, when you talk about any of your government paperwork that you're going to need, yeah, to file taxes, take your tax records with you.
I mean, obviously you're packing it, but that needs to be something you can get to, mm-hmm, not in the bottom of somewhere.
Absolutely. And along with that, it's been told to me many times to document as much as we can. We live in this digital age where we're seeing many, many pictures put up on Facebook, not only keeping us up to date, but a lot of the people that are going on there as well. But here's a very good idea for your own documentation for FEMA, if and when individual assistance is approved. I've got a feeling at this point that issue will be revisited, but document everything. Go into your house after it is completely cleaned out. Take pictures. Take pictures of everything, you know, overkill on this point, because the more information that you have, if and when the time comes to submit it to FEMA, the better chances that we have of getting individual assistance or getting the assistance that maybe you would be looking for if, in fact, that does come down the line. We're kind of putting the cart before the horse on this sense, but document now and afterwards. I can't stress that enough, because if nothing else, like Tom mentioned earlier, we will be rewriting record history books today when the Mouse River floods over its banks, when Minot floods.
Now, there was a question that we got on Facebook, you know, a couple hours ago, and there's no way I can find it, but I remember the question. Are people going to be allowed, let's say we're here because it start today's the day the Minot floods, but it's the beginning today. Today's not going to be the worst day. The highest numbers, the most water is going to be here, what, Tuesday or Wednesday of next week, right?
When we were actually looking at the very crest, we were looking at the 29th, yes.
29th. So the question was, are people going to be allowed maybe to go back in a boat to check out their house?
Here's the issue, and I'm going to venture to guess to say no, simply because of the extreme flows. You look at how fast this river is moving now, and with the emergency vehicles, you would literally be putting yourself at risk and then emergency people at risk as well for people trying to go through flooded out avenues and streets where the river is flowing at tremendous rates. I am venturing to guess you need to get out what you can now and don't plan on coming back until the all clear is given and you can drive back in. And I would be remiss to say that emergency crews are even going to let any of us back in once it floods.
You know, this was way back several weeks ago. I think it was you were telling me you saw on one of the someplace in town, maybe by your house, a bunch of geese or duck or something. They were on there and they were trying to stay in one spot and they were like flying. The river was moving so fast.
Yep.
And that was then. It's moving faster now.
Yeah, there's just a tremendous amount of water going through. And that's the other thing that even emergency officials want to address when they talk about the immediacy of evacuating when the dike is breached, when the water goes over the top, is that river will essentially start flowing through the streets. And then it'll start elevating to the point of where the river is at now. It will take some time to flood the streets. It will take some time to flood the homes. The water will spread out. But once that river starts flowing then again, you will see a little bit, I believe, in the river change once it breaches, but it will start flowing heavy again. And that's the dangerous part about it all. This is the bypass. This is the Highway 83 bypass. That is just to the west of Minot.
When was this picture taken?
It could have been taken anywhere in the last 48 hours from my memory. I actually was on the bypass earlier today as well. From this afternoon, okay.
I will tell you that when Joe Goldaddy was setting up the camera, he had to get on that road, and it took him 45 minutes to get from KX to the water treatment plant on 45 minutes.
And it took me a half hour to get from my house behind to a house behind Arrowhead, the shopping center, and back. It took me over a half hour, and we're only talking about 12 blocks.
Yeah.
That's only about 12 blocks. It took me more than a half hour.
Well, you know, I lucked out because I live up by the airport, and it took me about 6 minutes to get to the station.
I've got a feeling that's going to change once the valley is evacuated. It was amazing to see exactly how many cars and pickups and trailers and trucks and everything else that were down in the valley. It was lining every street. It didn't matter where you turn, you're thinking you're gonna take the corner and get around the traffic to avoid that four-way stop. It didn't matter. The streets were lined, the cars, everybody had the same idea
right.
that I did, so it just didn't matter. I need to correct one thing here, Sterling Kennels. They're saying that they're going to be open until 12 p.m. I've got to double check on here as I'm scrolling through, but I had said they were going to be open to 7 p.m., and that was incorrect. And now, of course, I've clicked on it.
It says, it says from Floyd Lemire, is that the last name, from Sterling Kennels? They will be open till midnight through the 26th.
Okay, so midnight through the 26th. We had reported 7 p.m., so it's going to be until midnight through the 26th. So thank you for that update there, Charity.
The mayor, when he called KX earlier tonight, he was talking about not going to bed right now. This is a work night. And not say, okay, I'm packed, I've got stuff in the car, let's wait till the sirens go off. Because once the sirens go off, you think this afternoon's traffic jams or something.
Yeah, and that's a point that we had to reiterate, is that you have to have a plan in place once you're down in the valley. If those bridges are closed off at 16th and at 6th and over by the zoo, those will certainly become a collection point of cars where everybody's now turning around and now trying to get out of the valley. And we have to be ready literally at a moment's notice, because not only were we talking at that 1556 mark being the magic number where the river flows over the top, but we have to keep in mind that we are working behind temporary levees that were built in haste. So it's not to say that any one moment a levee could go. So that is the other thing that we have to keep in our mind. We have that little false sense of security saying 1556, so we've got a foot and an inch roughly, or a foot and a little less than an inch. But these are temporary levees, and they are, there is stressed. A lot of unknown. They are stressed. When we get beyond that 2 foot of freeboard, that becomes kind of the instability building mark right there. That is the old 8th Street walking bridge right there. And I recognize it well.
This was from today, I believe.
Yes, that is today.
Also, a couple things. Now would be a good time to post any questions on Facebook. We had a lot of them coming in during KX News at 10, but they kind of got buried during the newscast. So if you would like to post some questions, you're still up. We know a lot of people may not necessarily be watching us on TV because the TV's packed, but are listening to us on either WGO Radio or the Zoo 94.9. So it's 102.9 or 94.9. And want to thank Jay and Gene for this, for allowing us to be on their radio station. Now, Eric is the other thing I was going to bring up is Eric just came back because you sent him on a little road trip.
I sent him down into the valley here to take a good look at the 16th Street Bridge here. We had that live webcam that had a little bit of water on the lens, so I asked Eric to take a little drive down, and did we get some video? What did you see?
Yeah, it's a little dark out there right now, but they got it lit up. They're still working away on the levee there, trying to protect the water treatment plant, and it's the water. I was there Sunday and got a little bit of video when I was there on Sunday, and it's gone up to just clipping that top of that bottom or the bottom of the bridge underneath. If we roll the video, you'll eventually see some of it, but there's crews working around. I talked to a guardsman while I was there. They got at least another 2-3 feet to go on the dikes that they're building right there. And that'll take, all night. And these trucks are constantly moving in and out. We'll eventually get to one.
I think that's a generated light there. Our high-definition camera actually picked up the flicker on
it. Eventually here, we'll get to one of the dump trucks. Well, there you can see the river and how close it is. It's not clear, but you can see the flow going underneath the bridge right there. This next shot, I think, is the dump truck trying to work its way up the hill. And right now, it's so slick and so wet out there that they're struggling getting up. And the guardsman I was talking to saying every so often, about half hour to an hour, they're bringing new clay to dump just in that spot so they can get more dirt or more clay up higher. To move.
So they're building a ramp essentially to get up onto the dike
to get
so they
onto
can dump
the dike
it.
Because it's so slick. And, I was walking back to the car with the equipment, and I was having a hard time walking. So that's what they're doing right now. The water is up there pretty high, and it's getting close enough to that bridge where it's getting close.
So in other words, that's the visual proof that heading down into the valley, that bridge is not going to be open for very much longer.
And yeah,
when we bring it up even another 4 or 5 inches, it could be the end of it.
Oh, absolutely. And the guardsman I was talking to, like you said, they're trying to get higher, a couple of feet higher by the end of the night, tomorrow morning, early tomorrow morning. They're not positive if they're going to block the road off yet. He wasn't sure what the plan was there, but for sure it's coming into the bridge to try and at least contain some of it out of it.
And at some point they could try to raise an area, but with the water flowing as it is, it may be just a futile attempt, and the only resounding answer might be to just block it off and then go back to a couple of the secondary or back roads that don't include bridges in Minot. And that's the unfortunate truth that so many of us are facing right now, is that our avenues of escape might be narrowed here in the next 3, 4, 5 hours.
It's slick out there, but they're working away, and they'll get it done hopefully by tomorrow, early morning.
Today, early morning. That's right. Tomorrow, when sunrise.
Welcome to
tomorrow.
Our world.
Welcome to our world. Absolutely. Well, thank you so much for stopping in, Eric, and getting that video. We'll rerun that here in just a little bit.
Debbie Mitchell posted that it took 25 minutes to get from the west end of 4th Avenue to 2 and 52.
Okay.
How far is that? A mile and a half?
2 and 52. From the west end to the east. Say that again.
Okay. From the west end of 4th Avenue to Highway 2 and 52.
from the west end of 4th Avenue.
So would that be the bypass?
To 252. That's basically, okay, so you're turning on the 83 bypass, right, heading down to the south to the stoplight down by Beams, and that took her a half hour.
25 minutes, yeah.
So you're talking only a couple of miles of sand. Well, I shouldn't say a couple of miles. Maybe that's about 4 miles, 3 miles, but that's a ridiculous amount of time to make it.
Especially at 1:30 in the morning. But you know what? If people are evacuating, at least they're doing it before the sirens go off, because from what we have been told, the sirens are going off today.
Without a doubt. There is not a doubt in my mind. Let's take this opportunity to take a short break at this moment. We're going to take a look at the river levels. We'll also check out Facebook. If you have any questions, please feel free to jump on there and post those, or if you have some answers to some other ones. But we will be back in just a couple of minutes as our live coverage continues around the clock on Flood Fight 2011 right here on KX News.
From KX News in high definition, this is a special report, Flood Fight 2011.
And good morning. It is 30 minutes past the hour of 1 o'clock on this Wednesday, a day that most likely will go down a little bit of infamy in the city of Minot. It will be the day that the Mouse River overtakes the levee system, and it's the day that Minot will flood. Good morning, Shaun Sipma, along with you with meteorologist Tom Schrader and a litany of other of our KX crew that are working around the clock to bring you the latest information and keeping you up to date on what's going on in and around Minot. I just want to go through some of the initial numbers here, Tom, as we talk about the crest. We've got a magic number. Actually, a couple of numbers we're working towards. I think first, before we get to the magic number, we are working our way towards an important crest number, which is 1555.4. That is the crest that took place during the 1969 flood. That is the highest level that it made for the 1969 flood. However, that will still be within the levee system of Minot, barring any breaches or breaks within that system, by about 6 inches. So that takes us to the magic number of 1556. That is at that point where the dike system will be overtaken, it will unstabilize, and Minot will flood.
Do we have the hydrograph so we can see the latest projection of what time of day? Do we have that? Piper, can we call that one up, or do you have it here?
I'm sure we can draw that up on our hydrograph.
Okay, she's looking for it here. We're throwing curveballs at them.
It's 1:30 in the morning. I think we can afford a moment or two reprieve here. And looking at that hydrograph, it is on a fairly stable upward climb at just about a 45-degree angle right now.
Which is a lot better angle than whether it got at Sherwood.
Sherwood is at literally almost a vertical climb, as nearly 27,000 CFS are going to be barreling down towards Lake Darling. Right now, we, according to this hydrograph, we would be right around that, and I have to click on the exact number to get that, but we are looking at the current level at 1554.95. That is flowing, according to the National Weather Service, at just over 9,500 CFS. So we are just shy of 10,000 CFS flowing through Minot right now.
At what point, because I can't see it from here, at what point do we hit 1556? Is that the number you're talking about?
That is the number that we're talking about, that magic number of 1556. I have to scroll down on my screen here. At 1556, this is putting it right at about, it's going to be today, and they have it posted for right around, they're saying midnight. According to this number, it would be midnight Thursday.
7 o'clock. Okay. Does that say, what's the number? It says 18, 0, 24?
It's 00 on the 23rd.
Okay, so that would be 7 o'clock. Because that's a UTC, right?
Yes.
At the top of the page, so that's London time?
UTC, correct.
I think that's 7 o'clock. I mean, I know that 0Z in weather terms, because we use that for our computer stuff, is 7 o'clock during daylight savings time.
Okay, yeah, okay, I see where you're going with that. Okay, so it'd be 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock is when, if everything goes according to schedule, Minot floods at 7 o'clock, roughly.
However, Minot Mayor Kurt Zimmelman really made that very clear during his live interview with Perry Olson right before the 10 o'clock news. Tonight he was at about 9:15 that he went on and was talking about the fact that it very well could breach before then. It could breach before that 6 o'clock mandatory evacuation. And he made it very clear to Minot residents that tonight is the night that we have to, if we need to get things out, work around the clock, get it done, and get out before that mandatory evacuation goes into effect, because the mouse could very well top its banks or at least breach at some point.
Could be a breach. It could top. I mean, these numbers change daily, but looking at that graph, it goes over the top at 7 o'clock tonight. But it could be earlier, so that's why you need to get things done.
One interesting little note here, as Mr. Christensen pointed out on our Facebook, you can actually track on some of the police scanners that you can put on your computer that Minot right now is the third most listened to police scanner in the world. So there are a lot of people that are tuned into the police scanners, listening to the chatter on what's going on, listening for any little tidbit or hint of what's going on right now throughout those police scanners. And getting back to a moment, I want to revisit that issue here as we're looking at numbers. The crest that we are heading towards is 1563. That is June 29th. We are working our way towards July, and we are talking about just then hitting our crest, which is expected to last for upwards of high river flows for 2 weeks. So it will be mid-July by the time that we actually start, if the plan from the Lake Darling Dam releases and the Canadian Watershed Authority releases our plan, that we could be into mid-July before these high water events start to just go down at that point.
Yeah, I mean, it's a long-term thing here. Here's something that Ashley Lawson put out here, and this makes perfect sense here, talking about restaurants. You know, the restaurants that have employees, they're going through the same thing as, you know, thousands of other people are. There's going to be long lines. It's going to take a while. You know, patience. And, you know, when I called this morning, I was fortunate enough that, you know, the plumber was in the neighborhood. And so they were able to stop by really quick. And they said, 2 o'clock, we have to shut down because we have 4 employees that we have to evacuate. So everybody's dealing with this, you know, one way or another. And so lines are going to be long. Patience will be
short.
You know, yesterday morning when I got off here, I went over to Menards thinking they opened up at 7. And it was actually 6:30, and there was a crowd of people there. And when we got, I was like the third person in the door. But by the time I got to the cash register, there was a line already. You know, so
we're gonna start seeing a lot of that. And along with that, somebody had posed the question of what restaurants are open. And to gauge that, it's you're gonna have to use the idea of what restaurants are out of the evacuation zones.
Yeah, because you can't be open, like the Burger King in the evacuation zone. I don't know if they're open like right now, but by tonight at 6.
I would venture to guess those restaurants have all closed up, trying to tear out as much as they can to save.
Yeah, I would think so. I haven't seen that anywhere.
And with that, the restaurants also, I'm sure there might be an instance or two where a lot of the employees are out evacuating. I don't know what the situation is. You're going to have to use it a case-by-case basis. A phone call ahead might be your safest bet. Things are certainly going to be different in Minot for a vast majority of time.
And you just triggered something here. I know you're grabbing some notes, but you triggered something that came in earlier. Case-by-case, apartment dwellers, because there's no one-size-fits-all with this. Every landlord's different. Every lease is different. You know?
And to answer the question, who's in charge of what, I don't even have an answer for that, because that I guess would be between the issue of the landlord and the tenant, and I'm sure we will be visiting those issues when it comes time for cleanup. It's not just homeowners, it's apartment rent, people who are renting apartments, it's people who have individuals who own multiple homes that rent them out and things like that.
And look at it this way. I mean, this is not an immediate problem, because if your apartment floods, you're not getting in next week.
Would venture to guess weeks, if not longer, before we even have to come to that road. What I was reaching for here, Mike, I want to go ahead, and we've got some video here that has been put together by Stephanie. Basically just a montage of the pictures that have been on Facebook that she was kind enough to grab and throw together in a little bit of video. I don't know if we can cue that up. And what's that, Mike? Oh, here we go. All right. This first one is the National Guard by MSU. That is from Brandy Shar. As you can see, the Humvee there right by the Minot State University sign, helping direct traffic. And this is the truck hauling clay down Broadway by Brandy Shar as well. We've seen a vast many of those in and around Minot in the valley. Kayla, the girl on the roof, this is Cindy Freeman from Kramer, who obviously is taking a little bit of humor within this flood. I think something that we could all use at this time. Truck and water near the KOA campgrounds. This is Cody Messine. Thank you so much for that. You can see what the Mouse River is doing to the roadway there. The truck dumping clay from Brandy Shar as well. I've got an infinite number of pictures in my own JPEG files of this, and many more to come until this fight is over. Green Thumb, back road to Burlington by Brandy Shar as well. And you can see just how much water has been pumped, pushing even over the road at that point. On Highway 52 by the KOA campgrounds, a dump truck leaving after going to Minot. That's Cody Messine as well. Next one is Men on the Dike by Brandy Shar. They're going through and doing all the measurements. We've seen them in and around the dike system for weeks, walking every inch of it, measuring to make sure of the levels. The National Guard directing traffic on Broadway, also from Brandy. Thank you. And they've been very instrumental in helping the flow from these heavy trucks get to where they need to be. One car on the bypass. Brandy Shar, I don't know if this is the right one. It's actually a road closed sign there. From Baker's Bridge. There we go. This is the bypass bridge by Brandy Shar as well. The water is just unimaginable on what's coming through the Mouse River. The man walking the dike, also by Brandy, another person who's doing a little bit of inspecting. I'm not sure if that would be the Army Corps of Engineers or a National Guard person right there. And then we have the Souris River Basin, 128th Avenue and County Highway 15. Impassable at its finest, to say the least. The cars in the bypass, lines and lines of cars that Terry Gross sent on Facebook. They're talking about half hour waits or longer. Colton Bridge in Burlington, water pouring over, and another sign that says welcome to Burlington. The KOA campground sign has kind of been an icon on the roads, road as many of us have gone to view some of the flooding, and we've driven by this many times, and the KOA campground seems to be just sinking lower and lower. This is the one of Perry Olson taking out his big screen. Melissa took this picture, former KX employee here, former co-anchor of mine. Thank you so much for keeping us up to date on what Perry's doing. 54th Avenue, east of the KOA campgrounds here, Peyton Horn. This is actually Tyson Floberg there. And then this is the Carlo Welsh Waterrood over by Logan, the bridge that has a significant amount of water on there. Near Souris Valley Golf Course, Michelle Tweeten Schmidt. More and more devastation just everywhere we look. Again, this is over by the golf course. As we saw, the pressure just blow those sandbags right into the basement, water rushing in. That's just hard to believe as flooded out basement.
That picture before that was 11 o'clock. This is noon. That was 1 hour difference in the pictures.
And we're going to find out how true that is in Minot today as the Souris is over top by Tanya Idy, 27th Street Southwest. Water just inundating over the road at 27th Street. Another shot of 27th Street as we could see the impassable water making its way into that area as backup water from the Mouse makes its way into there. We showed you this one a little bit earlier. This is the apartment complex and it indicates the 69 flood level, and add 8 feet on top of that, and that's where our current projections are at. The empty store shelves at Miracle Market that had to empty them out once again. Thank you, Cody, for sending in this one. Again, we can't say enough about the businesses and homes that have had to evacuate. Third Street Bridge, this is looking to the west from that Third Street Bridge towards Broadway. Tammy, thank you. You've got a great sense of humor, or at least thank you for taking the picture. I refuse to leave. Up to Sherwood now. This is an area of contention because this is where the water enters into the Mouse on the Mouse River first into North Dakota, and those flows are going up each and every moment. Water treatment plant in Minot from Jeff. as they continue to raise the dikes in an attempt to save the water treatment plant and in hopes of maintaining our drinking water. And then that 6th Street walking bridge that is actually over by my house. I've been watching that one very closely, and it's a tough sight to see the one go under. I actually was walking across that about a week ago. Over on, this is over near Central Avenue, First International Bank attempting to save the bank building there from the floodwaters that are coming in. And this is looking to the, I want to say the east, over towards 3rd Street, over by the bridge. And then another house that you can see just how much room is, very little room is left on the levee systems taken today here in Minot. The Roosevelt Walking Bridge also inundated. They've got the guard crossings blocking that, but water coming up right at the bottom and ready to overtake the walking bridge. I know this is one of the houses down along, I believe, 6th Street or in that region, right down in my area, 4th Avenue, somewhere in that region. But yeah, this is the fairgrounds that we're looking at. And you can see just how much water has come up. And I'm not sure if that's Mouse River water or if that is actual storm sewer backup. I know that was an area that had an issue with that not too long ago. But it'd be my guess that
I would think we would have heard if that was.
Yeah, that would be storm sewer backup, yeah. I believe, at that point.
Now, Stephanie, I know that if you're in the newsroom listening, two things. Nice job on that. And two, we have a request already. If you could, can we post that as an album that we can share so people can share it with their families? I don't know enough about this to know if that's possible, but is there a way we can post those? Do you know, Shaun?
Basically, all we have. What's that?
We can put it up.
Okay, why don't you go ahead and put it on Facebook.
We're going to put that on Facebook. So
that way people can go through and
Casey,
and
thank
we
you.
Certainly appreciate all of those people that put those pictures up for us to say. And that was a couple of weeks ago, that fairground picture. That was that sewer, that was from that big rainfall where the storm sewers had backed up and had.
Charity just straightened that out. Thank you.
Yep, I appreciate that. Thank you so much. We were talking about evacuations earlier, and Mike, we're going to be heading into this video here in just a moment, but we had mentioned that the mayor during his interview told us that we have to be ready. We have to be ready to get out of the valley at a moment's notice when those emergency sirens sound. It will have that message that now is the time to go. They will sound those when the dikes breach or the water goes over the top of the dikes, and it's at that time to leave immediately. However, evacuation time for the Terracito Vallejo just west of Minot today ran short. A low spot in the dike allowed the water to back into the ditches and inundate the only road into that community. Dean Leonards with the Emergency Operations Center said that the Corps and the National Guard were in the area trying to slow down that amount of water that was coming in. And in the meantime, the Sheriff's Department was going door to door ordering that immediate evacuation.
The first time they came by, they said the levee had been broke, or the dike had been compromised, so we needed to get out as soon as possible. That was probably about an hour ago. This is my brother-in-law's place, so we just got here like an hour ago, and we tried to get out all the main appliances and so forth. So they're saying it's going to come up above the garage door, is what they told us. So
the water's rushing over the road over here and getting deeper and deeper. That's your only way out, right?
Yes, that is the only way out of here. So we're. They came by about half hour ago and said two more minutes and you have to go. And if you're in a car and not an SUV, you won't be able to get out.
And getting out was an issue. The water had come over the road and risen noticeably just in that 45 minutes that I think it was Jennifer that was down in the Terracito Vallejo area. In that amount of time, only trucks and SUVs were able to get through that amount of water that had come into that area. We're going to take just a short break here, take a few moments to go through some more notes and update some information here. We'll go through river levels when we come back and also have the story of a family that is going through yet a flood that had been through another flood in Minot years and years ago. We will continue our coverage live on KX News of Flood Fight 2011 when we come back.
From KX News in high definition, this is a special report. Flood Fight 2011.
Good morning. It is 8 minutes to the top of the hour of 2 a.m. on this Wednesday, the day that is certainly going to go down in infamy for the city of Minot. The Magic City is the day that Minot floods. It is not a question any longer. It is a matter of when, not if. We are continuing to watch the river levels rise in the Magic City as a new number has just come in. The Maus River continues its rise, going up 2/10 of an inch at 1554.97. So we are marching closer to that 1555 mark.
That's actually the smallest climb.
That is the smallest climb in hours, and it's certainly welcome news. But unfortunately, what that does mean, though, is it is giving us more time to evacuate within the city of Minot. That evacuation time has been set for 6 p.m. within Minot, and then for Burlington, that time is noon. However, that is that could all be thrown out the window at any moment if a dike should breach. And once that dike breaches, the city sirens will sound, the reverse 911 system will go into effect, and it's at that moment that you are required, not asked, but required to leave immediately, because that means that the area is starting to flood.
You know, something if I could address here, because, you know, we have a lot of people who have just moved to North Dakota, you know, working in the oil fields or related industries and stuff, and maybe not living in a place that has tornadoes. The sirens or it's an outdoor program. It's an mm-hmm. outdoor system. It's designed to be heard outdoors. So many of you may have never heard this,
yep.
The sirens going off. But I can assure you that Sean's phone right there is on the reverse 911. We're plugged into everybody that could possibly be plugged into. So when the sirens are going off, we will be letting you know. A lot of folks that are being evacuated certainly have cleaned out their house by now, probably listening to us on the radio, on either WGO radio or the zoo. And so, you know, they'll know, everybody's going to know. Minot will know when the sirens are going off.
And that could come well before that 6 p.m. hour of evacuation. Like
the hydrograph says 7 o'clock, but a levee could breach, something could fail, it could get here a little bit quicker. Right now, you know, the scheduled time, if you want to call it that, would be around 7 o'clock tonight when the water starts going over the top.
All right. And then thousands of homeowners in the evacuations are trying really to make the best of a very, very difficult situation. It's certainly not easy to leave the home that you've become attached to, but that's even more difficult from the situation if you've gone through floods before. Carla Burbage caught up with one such family earlier today.
This neighborhood, like others in the evacuation zones, is filled with lots of cars and people, and there's a buzz of activity. Too bad it's not a neighborhood block party. In a matter of hours, the homes will be empty. This home belongs to Don and Bertha Wald behind the Arrowhead Shopping Center. Don built his home in 1962 and has been through the 69 flood and two in the 70s. The water has been close, but never gotten in their home before. This time may be different.
What do you think this time around about getting water?
I'm scared. I mean, it's if it hits what they say, I'm hoping that these predictions will lower a little bit as it spreads out in the valley, but I don't know.
Fortunately for the Walds, they have lots of family, 9 kids, 26 grandkids, and 2 great-grandkids with another on the way. They have plenty of help. They realize it is just a house and everything can be replaced. Yet they have a lot invested in their home, years of living and raising a family, and Don has done all the original work and the additions himself.
And we've just added on, and we finally got the house just like we want it, and put new stuff in, Oliver, and now with that floods, there goes all the work, and I'm crying inside.
Time is drawing to a close. The neighborhood will soon be empty, and the residents will get in this line of traffic on Minot City streets, not knowing when they will return or how their lives will be changed. In Minot, Carla Burbage, KX News.
As we see there, the evacuations fully underway, and along with that, as people begin the evacuations or continue the evacuations or are wrapping up their evacuations, lines down these streets are getting longer. We showed you a little bit ago, maybe we could even call that video up, Mike, that Eric had been out shooting along the 16th Street Bridge. That bridge has been one of those that has been targeted that is certainly getting closer and closer to closure as that river climbs higher and higher. The earlier today, we had set up a couple of live streaming webcams, but this was the video that Eric shot. And that flickering is actually one of the generated powered lights out there. A high-definition camera actually captured the flickering. But you can see that the crews are still working, even at this late hour, trying to shore up those dikes along the water treatment plant, building them higher and higher. And as we had some of those rain showers moving through, Tom, that's creating a very slippery situation on those clay, basically roads that are getting just covered in clay as those trucks are going through.
Besides slowing things down, it's dangerous.
It's dangerous. It is slipping and sliding, and they were actually bringing in fresh clay and essentially building ramps like you're seeing here as this dump truck is trying to back up and unsuccessfully doing so. So they were actually dumping clay and building ramps onto these levees as they're trying to build them, and crews putting in an unbelievable amount of time trying to save city infrastructure. It's a little hard to see here, but what you're looking at is the bridge itself and the water that's it's flowing right up to the base of it on the bottom and threatening to shut it down. This is the live streaming video, I believe, as you can see some of the cars. We're going to have to bring this up a few more times. It looks like our lens has finally cleared up a little bit. You can
this
see.
This is the 16th Street one?
This is the 16th.
Broadway? This is 16th? Yeah, because the Broadway, we'd be seeing trains.
We'd be seeing trains at this point. This is the water treatment plant in the foreground. In the background, you see the 16th Street Bridge. Cars slowly going over as some of that heavy equipment. You can see a truck backing in right now as it is going in for another load of clay to dump down. And you can see the water. If you look really closely in the bottom left, right kind of where that long streaming light reflection is coming from. But that is the water that is pushing up against the bridge, right where that arrow's at, right there. You can see the water moving at a very good clip. On the other side, that bright green trees that are now, you know, well within the water's grasp as we work towards the flood ending of our fight sometime later today, as now, late as 7 o'clock, from what the hydrographs are showing, as early as any moment where a breach could mean the end of it, end of the fight.
Now, a couple things. One, this is one camera. We also have a camera, and I know we can't switch to it right away, but we have a camera up on overlooking the Broadway Bridge. I think it's right off Central, not actually on Central Avenue, but pretty close.
Pretty close
and
to Central,
and then Bob Berger, our engineer, got our old Skycam.
The very old Skycam.
It's been out of service for a long time. Well, there's the one. This would be the one overlooking Broadway Bridge, right?
Yes, the Broadway Bridge.
And you can actually see Broadway in the back.
That is correct. You can actually see they've illuminated those very, very bright lights in the very background. That's where they're doing more dike work, building up that secondary dike. And we'll I want to talk more about that in a moment, about that secondary dike. But you can see in the background where they're working on those. And in the foreground, that's where the river is at. We talked about this when we put this up, that we might be impeded every now and again on this camera by a train that's passing through. But I have this sneaking suspicion when the water goes over the levees and starts to flood the area, we're not going to have too many trains.
So hopefully they don't park one there. And then Bob Berger, can we go to the Skycam? So this is our old one. I mean, it's not HD or anything, but you know what? We're looking, it's dark, but you're looking at Broadway Avenue, kind of the green lights there, I guess. And I think the camera is almost looking right at where the river would be.
That is correct. And this camera will be of a lot more use during daylight hours, I believe. Even as early as 5 a.m., we've only got about 3 hours to go already just to get to 5 o'clock. But this is going to give us a good view from North Hill. And then we've also got those two streaming cameras. And thank you so much to Joe Golddaddy, our, let's just be honest, technological genius as far as I'm concerned, for getting some of this put in place, simply because we really can't be able to be in some of these places to get live shots just because of the danger of being in the way of all of this truck traffic and people trying to evacuate. We would be impeding that effort. So these live cameras are instrumental in being able to bring all of us these pictures. And as I mentioned yesterday morning when we were talking about this, it's almost my own morbid curiosity and fascination, but I certainly would love to be able to see the very moment where that river goes over and floods the area. That's going to be the march towards my house. And in knowing that
is there
that's
a best guesstimate on where it's going to happen first? What's the lowest area?
They haven't talked about that. They've tried to re-level everything up to that 1556 mark. That would give everybody all the same amount of time in Minot to get their stuff out. So I don't know if there's any one single area that's been targeted as the breach area. I know today across from the river from even my house on the other side of 4th Avenue over by Oak Park, that they were actually adding sandbags on top of the levee. We knew this was a losing fight, but that was kind of a low area, but they wanted to put more protection in there to give everyone the equal amount of time to get things out of their homes, to get everyone evacuated in short order. So I am almost certain there isn't a one single area. There might be a few areas that are of concern because of seepage already. There's an area right where basically 6th Street wraps around and meets and becomes 8th Street on the way to University, where there has been seepage through that dike system. They added all those sandbags right across the 6th Street Bridge. Not to say that that's one of the areas where it's going to break, but just different areas of concern at some point.
You know, earlier today there was some concern when Perry Olson was at the 4 o'clock press conference, I guess, and they were talking about building the dike, that trying to keep Broadway open, and I think 3rd. A side benefit of that was it might protect a lot of houses, in maybe several hundred houses.
And I think at this point we should probably bring up the evacuation zone. Perry was talking about this right around the 9 o'clock hour, if we can find that, and zoom down into that area of evacuation zone five, and then 9, and then part of 6. I don't know if we can reach down into that.
And we had a few things popping up on Facebook, people wondering, okay, so if I'm on the wrong side of that, does this mean I'm going to get a lot of extra water?
Absolutely not.
And, you know, they were kind of irritated, thinking they were being the sacrificial lambs. That's not what's supposed to happen here.
Absolutely. And if we look at 5, okay, so the idea of the secondary dike, this is to protect Broadway. They did not want to build a dike on top of Broadway the way they did in 1969, because after that flood, it was kind of the idea that was actually impeding the water flow so much that they figured that's what caused the flood to last longer. That's not the case this time. They actually, just on the other side of the edge of the west edge of 5, you can right along 3rd Street. I have to think here.
So the number, the line between, you know, I'll explain. So the line between 4 and 5, vertical line.
Yes, correct.
That
would be 3rd Street, just to the left of it. They've gone and put a secondary dike down 3rd Street. That goes all the way down to the bridge. And then underneath the bridge, they wind that secondary dike and then basically wrap it around to Railroad Street.
So can we get a cursor on there just because... I've seen this a bunch of times, and I've just kind of been afraid to ask a question.
It's still kind of difficult to envision.
So if we can we get the cursor on this? Now, that's the vertical line right down there. Is that where Sammy's is? Is that what we're talking about?
Sammy's would be right down in the bottom right-hand side. You know what we should do, Tom? Let's set up your weather board and put this on the background. We'll stand up here and kind of explain.
Oh, okay, we can do that.
We'll take a few moments
during a break.
Tell you what, let's take a break here. We're going to come back and revisit this, because I would like to actually stand up there and point out what is what on where the secondary dike is at. That should better explain it. We'll take a short break, kick it to CBS, and come back in just a few moments and explain what's going on with the secondary dike, which zones could be saved a little bit or wholly by this. And we'll come back in just a few moments with our live coverage from KX News, Flood Fight 2011.
From KX News in high definition, this is a special report, Flood Fight 2011.
And good morning. It is 11 minutes past the hour of 2 o'clock on this Flood Fight 2011. We are continuing our live coverage. We've kind of changed things up here a little bit. We're going to try to explain a little bit about what's going on with this secondary dike system that is in attempt to free up Broadway. We've actually got this nice big map that we've blown up here, and we're going to try to explain where exactly. Tom and I were trying to explain this. It's difficult with one of these maps unless we actually just throw it up on the weather board here. I'm not a meteorologist, so I'm going to attempt to. But this basically red line right here between 4 and 5, this is Broadway right here. So if we go up here to 3rd Street, it's basically from 3rd Street, which is just...
The horizontal line is 3rd Street?
This is Broadway. The red line is Broadway. If we go one street to the west, that's 3rd Street. If that would be the area that right off University, there is a large dike that is already built right down the middle of the street. That was part of the secondary, and it goes to right behind the barley pop in that area. And that's built all the way down to the bridge right down here. A huge clay dike that they've actually been shoring up even today. They've got this dike right here on the just west, one street west of Broadway. And that goes underneath the viaduct. This is the bridge right here, the big Broadway bridge. It goes underneath the viaduct and then wraps around. And we saw that on the one camera that is over by the secondary camera. It's over by Central Avenue looking to the north, northwest. So towards right at Sammy's Pizza, essentially. So it's wrapping around up on Railway Avenue and then wraps around up into this area right here as well. And then continues on, and I believe continues on all the way around Railway Avenue up into this section right here. This is the secondary dike. So it stretches Railway Avenue all the way underneath the viaduct up to 3rd Street, and then, wraps away all the way around to the Broadway Bridge, and then up to 3rd Street and all the way north.
So that protects 5, that protects, most of 9,
that protects
some of 6.
The upper part of 5. It protects one street within 4th Avenue.
So not a lot, but
one
some.
Some, and then it protects all of 9 and the upper part of 6 that essentially is going to be following that Railway Avenue right up in here. So kind of the northern tier of 6, and it all of this stuff right in here and then north. So you've got all of 9, the portion of 6 that's within Railway Avenue, the upper portion of 5 as it wraps around to underneath the viaduct. So you've got all of these homes up in here. Now, we want to say that they are building this secondary levee.
And there's no guarantee this is going to work.
There is, absolutely, Tom, there is no guarantee that this is going to work, but this is their attempt to keep Broadway, our north-south route through Minot, open and free, because if we lose Broadway, that's severely going to hinder traffic and, let's be honest, commerce through the Magic City. All that would be left, in essence, would be the bypass. And there has been a little bit of talk on whether the bridge at Broadway or some of the roads because of the backwater. I've got a feeling they are going to attempt to make sure that that bypass stays open at any cost as well, and along
also
with Broadway.
We need to point out that even if you're in, you know, 5, 9 areas that are hopefully protected, when the sirens go off, and they will today, you still have to leave.
These are still mandatory evacuation zones. It doesn't matter if you're on the side of the dike or not, you are required to leave.
Yeah, even if you don't get a drop, you're still out.
Yeah. When the siren sounds, or if we make it to that 6 o'clock hour tonight, 6 p.m. tonight, I'll go through this one more time here now. Okay, so we've got evacuation zones 4 and 5. This is Broadway right here on the red line that runs vertical. 3rd Street is right here, and they have got a secondary dike that is tremendously huge that was built on that last time that they worked on the secondary dikes. They never took that down. They had taken a little part, I want to say, that was right in here over by the barley pop just for through traffic. They're closing that up and building it all the way underneath the viaduct and wrapping it around to Railway Avenue and then working essentially along this line to keep this section, all of this section right in here, protected. And it, in essence, wasn't built to protect all of the homes. It's using to protect infrastructure.
It's just kind of a byproduct.
It's a byproduct that we're saving homes. And unfortunately, my home, I can show you right here. I'll show you where I live. I am right down in this area right here. That's my house. And unfortunately, I am far and beyond, my house is far and beyond any amount of saving as well. So I will gladly say if we can save some homes out of this flood, I couldn't be more than happy for the people that are down there. But as Tom mentioned, that once those sirens sounds, all evacuation zones, 1 through 9, I'll step off here and you can kind of take a look. 7 is over here in the corner, you can't quite see it, but all 9 sections have to go. And when those sirens sounds, it's evacuate immediately. Thank you. We'll zoom out here a little bit.
Now, I had a couple questions here that we can, while you're there, Shaun. First off, let's say zone 9 ends up being fine.
Okay.
The question is, would that mean they would be able to return early? We don't know that.
No, I will honestly say that is something the city leaders will address much later, because right now they're only worrying about getting those secondary dikes built up to protect infrastructure. At some point, and if you remember during the first evacuation, obviously we didn't flood, so they reevaluated the risk of allowing people back into those evacuated zones. And as the Corps officials talked about, any secondary or temporary levee that is built in haste. It's not properly packed, there isn't vegetation, so there is the chance of erosion. So they may actually keep those evacuation zones out until the river actually goes down, those high flows are reversed. The good side is, yeah, you may be evacuated, but your house could be fine. I mean, that's a big plus, Tom. Now we've got this on a little smaller scale. It might be easier for me to talk
about. Well, and now I can ask you another question here from Heather. And how about, can you find where the Boys and Girls Ranch is? And maybe Robinwood Estates, is that what it's called?
Robinwood Estates, you're talking about an area that is outside of Minot here. I'll have to get my bearings here a little bit. But as we look, and I'm going to have to walk all the way across here, this is going to be the bypass area right out in this section right here. This is the bypass right out in here. So the Boys and Girls Ranch is going to be off screen. If I can point, it's going to be, I believe, right down in here. County Road 15 is right along that area. And this is the Minot evacuation zone map. We would actually have to pull up a Ward County map on that. To give you an idea, I can point out some areas of reference right in here. In Section 3, this is Oak Park right in here. You've got the Oak Park Shopping Center in this area. Prickett Elementary is going to be right down here. In Evacuation Zone 4, you've got Minot State University, and I believe that's going to be up in this section if I'm correct on. Let's see here. We've got Nubbin Park. And we're going to go up to University Avenue up in this area. So this is going to be Minot State University. This is the Broadway Bridge right in this section right here. And then Sammy's Pizza is going to be right in this area as well. Once I get past that area, we're going to be over into the Roosevelt Park Zoo area. And that is right in this area as well. And beyond that, as far as landmarks go, I get a little bit fuzzy. I think this is Souris Drive right down in Evacuation Zone 7.
That's where Jim lives.
That is where the Olsons are at right there in Evacuation Zone 7.
I just had someone call asking where the zoo was.
Where the Roosevelt Park Zoo. It's in Evacuation Zone 6, and I may be off here. I'm going to have to grab my bearings when we look at Broadway. And then essentially you can go find Burdick Expressway, and I've got to back out here
a little
bit.
Can we zoom that at all?
Can we zoom down into Area 6 for me, Mike? That might help me immensely to try to get my bearings here to find Burdick and Broadway, or to find Burdick Expressway. That's going to be the easiest way to find this, right down into Zone 6 even a little more.
Now, and I want to point out here that some people at home probably don't know this. Shaun has to read this off of a non-HD monitor because when we watch HD, because of all the way the stations are laid out now with this digital transition to digital, he would be looking at a map with a delay on it, and where he points and talks
I'm actually
two or
turn
three
around.
Seconds behind.
Okay,
so.
The Burdick Viaduct, I can tell you, looking around.
So he's finding it now, and he'll walk over.
That's Burdick Expressway. So the zoo is going to be right down in this area. It's going to be right down in this area, right here to the best. I actually have to turn around.
Now he's trying to look at the HD map.
Yep, I'm looking at the HD and then going to turn back around. This is the big Roosevelt Park up in this area, and then the zoo is going to be right down here. So this is going to be the area that we've had a little bit of contention with as well. Here's the bridge that Jim Olson shot on his walkthrough right away this morning. I've got my bearings a little better. So the zoo is up in this area. The bridge on Burdick Expressway, we've got the Roosevelt Park through here. You're going to have the pool. The water slides right in here. You've got that big bend in the river, and this is going to be the road right on Railway Avenue. You can see the railroad tracks right here. They're building that dike system, that secondary dike right in here. This is going to be back roads to, say, Lowe's Garden Center right back in here. And then the State Fair Center is way over here in the corner in this area back up in here, and that technically is Ward County. but that's going to be on the far edge of your screen, the state fair. And to give you an update on the state fair now, they have finished with the dike that has been protecting the state fair, that is going to be protecting the state fair center. They are currently working on a dike system around the grandstands, that $12 million grandstands that they finished last year. So just quickly, I'll run through one more time before we kind of move on. Or Tom's
okay, got well, another question. I just want to try to bring in some more Facebook stuff here.
Sure.
And let's see if you really do have your weatherman's merit badge here.
I'm going to step off.
Working
here.
That blue wall there. Okay. First off, and I'm going to tie this together, if we can get the control room, and we may have to go back and forth here, and there may be a bit of a lag, the camera that looks at 16th, the water treatment plant,
okay.
the webcam. So let's take a look at that when we get a chance here. And you know what? Part of an issue that we've been having throughout the night is there are so many people watching it. We're getting, you know, people in Hawaii watching our streaming video that sometimes we don't have access to it. But can you point out where that 16th Street in the water plant would be, what zone it's in? And then we found out after making some phone calls, Eric Manlove made some phone calls regarding this issue about are they getting ready to close off the road. And at this point, their answer is the plan is to keep it open as long as they possibly can.
Yes.
If there is anything different, we will hear about it and we will pass it on.
This one is actually a little bit difficult to point out because they don't show the river on a really good basis because of the lines here. I can see it on the HD, so it's going to take me a moment to get my bearings here. Okay, so we've got 16th, which is all the way over here. This is 16th Street, and you can see it comes up along here, 16th Street, and here's the river. This is essentially the area that we're talking about, all the way down here. Yeah, if we zoom down, yep, there we go a little bit. The river follows this red line between section 1 and 2. 16th is right in this area, so that bridge is going to be right here. That's the area that we're looking about, and it would be essentially section 1 that we're looking at, because the water treatment plant is going to be right in this area, and we're looking over the water treatment plant. So our camera is essentially right here looking at the river. Our live camera is going to be down here looking at the river. For a little bit of reference, point two, Ramstead Middle School is going to be right up in here in section 4. I can't point here and look here. I'm not a weatherman, but this is Ramstead Middle School.
Trinity Hospital, and will they get water?
Trinity Hospital. Okay, I'm going to step off and take a look at my...
What a tour guide.
My tour guide here. Trinity Hospital. I looking at this, it's Burdick Expressway. And when you're talking about Trinity Hospital, you're talking about up in this area right here. It is not going to catch water at the hospital. If you look at the topography, a lot of people were asking, well, is downtown Minot going to catch water? If you've ever been in downtown Minot, you drive up to North Hill, basically going up Main Street. And let me step off here, and I can find the Main Street in Minot. Main Street is right... Okay, it's basically essentially right here. Here's Main Street. And if you look, the old Soo Line Depot is going to be right in here. There are a couple of businesses, and I'm not sure. I would really have to zoom down and see if 10 North Main, that's a restaurant some of us are familiar with.
And that's very close to the camera that we're looking at Broadway Bridge.
That's,
I mean, we're
very
talking
true.
About 25 yards.
Yes, and our camera is right up in this area looking at the river towards that Broadway Bridge right here. But you're talking about Main Street Minot that is going to be right in here, and Trinity Hospital's all the way up on the hill. It is not going to come anywhere near Trinity Hospital in Minot. So don't that is not a concern whatsoever as far as the hospital is concerned. Anything up on the hill, when you start driving up the hill away from, you've got South Broadway, you've got Burdick Expressway East. Once Burdick Expressway, here's Burdick. Once you start getting down into that river valley again around evacuation zone number 6, and once you start heading towards the river, obviously heading towards that bridge, that's where you're going to start running into that evacuation zone within 6. Okay, Valley Street, that's a good question. It's right here, actually. Valley Street is going to be right into here. So Valley Street on both sides, you're actually very close to the evacuation zone of number 6, but here's Valley Street right in here. So you can see that you're only a block or two, depending on which how you look at it. You're not even a block. You're a row of houses, essentially, away from the evacuation zone, which is on Eastern Avenue, following number 6. And the one thing that we have to keep in mind here, we're also looking at the evacuation zones, but the inundation maps. And by inundation maps, that's where they're projecting the water to go once it reaches 1552. This is the inundation map, I believe.
1562.
Or 1562. I'm sorry. I've got my numbers here a little backed up here at 2:27 in the morning. But this is the inundation map at 1562, if I'm not mistaken. Am I correct on this, Tom? They haven't figured 63.
No, that's all the bigger. They don't have a map.
They haven't figured out. So here, this is why we actually have zones like number 2. Then there's areas in the white that are within that zone. That's because they believe at 1562 that these areas will have water. However, the inundation maps, they haven't got figured out as far as maps drawn up that are going to show everything that has water. And at 1562, I mean, you look up into this section as well, they figure some of these areas are going to have water as well. To what extent and to what depth, that remains to be seen. There's really no good answer. You could even pose that question to the Army Corps of Engineers, and I don't think they're going to have that answer, to be honest.
Now, there's something, this might be a good time to take a break, because I see something popping up here on our website that, or on the Facebook site, that I would like to talk with you off camera before we start making observations about this.
Okay.
Because it could be a significant, something significant, and it may not be, and and I'm not trying to make excuses for anybody or us, but like thousands of people in Minot, everybody in the control room, we've been up a while, and I want to make sure we're not reading too much into this. So if we could take a break, you and I can talk about something, and we'll address it when we come back.
All right.
From KX News in high definition, this is a special report, Flood Fight 2011.
And good morning. It is 37 minutes past the hour of 2 o'clock. Shaun Sipma along with meteorologist Tom Schrader as we continue our round-the-clock coverage of Flood Fight 2011. We're looking at our live streaming video. This is looking down in the foreground of Minot Water Treatment Plant along with the Mouse River right behind it and the 16th Street Bridge in the background. Now, what we're looking at right here, we've set this up so I can actually stand out and point out a few things. Now, what we're looking at, you can see that there is some flashing lights here. We've had a couple of concerns that they're already blocking off that 16th Street Bridge. Now, we haven't seen a whole lot of traffic come along 16th Street Road. 16th Street is right along here. We had some concerns that they were actually blocking that off already. It's been our indication, Eric Manlove went down to that location earlier, and what they've been doing a lot of times is the Minot Police Department will block off the road as we've had trucks coming in. They're building this secondary levee essentially all around here, right in front of the treatment plant, trying to protect the water treatment plant. So when the Mouse River goes over its banks, that we will still be able to maintain our treatment plant. Here comes actually one of the cars down the road. There is traffic going over the bridge at this point, and they're just trying to allow some of those dump trucks in and out to be able to get that work done as quickly as possible. So that's what's going on at the water treatment plant right now at this hour. We will continue to check in on that because one of the main concerns that Mayor Zimbelman talked about in that earlier meeting is that when the water comes up enough, is that that's the problem of we're going to have to shut down some of the bridges. And I don't know if we can bring up that graphic right now that shows the river level. We actually hit a benchmark right now at 1555.02 within, yes, there it is, 1555.02. It's showing the Mouse River on its climb, heading towards that magic number of 1556. That is the stage at which our levees are going to be breached. Now, this number at 1555.02 at the top right of your screen is actually taken off the USGS website on their on their real-time readings. The National Weather Service updates theirs every now and again, which is why you see the reading here at a little bit lower level, but the USGS has those real-time readings, and that's where
they come in every
numbers.
15 minutes, roughly.
Okay, so it's about a 15-minute update to where the Weather Service is an hourly update, maybe a little longer than that. Now, there's something else, Tom, that we had a question about we were addressing. That's why we took the break talking about flows. Go ahead and
let me explain this. You know, Jeff sent us a...
While we do that, let's have Piper bring up that reading from Sherwood.
Okay, what we're going to do is show you the new projection for Sherwood. And I know there's a lot of people that are listening on the radio while they're evacuating, they're driving, they're stuck in cars, and you can't see this on TV. So we are going to try to describe this the best we can. Now, the way it was presented to us in the question a little while ago, and I have to go back to an earlier post from Jeff, was that the big water going into Sherwood is arriving 2 days early. And because of that, are we going to be able to draw Lake Darling down enough? Because all the plans were to draw down Lake Darling, get some storage space, so when this water does arrive, you know, there's going to be at least a little bit of time to fill up Lake Darling. And if this is coming 2 days early, are those plans shot? Is kind of paraphrasing.
Well,
now, first off, for those of you that are driving around listening on the radio, that line, it's been a horizontal line for river flow up until this afternoon. Was that, this afternoon? And then all of a sudden, you know, early this evening, it's almost a vertical line up to major flood stage, it looks like. So that's kind of a picture. The line has gone from horizontal to vertical. And Shaun, you made some observations that we're trying to figure out at 2 o'clock in the morning.
That's right. At 2 o'clock in the morning, I mean, it's...
We're going to flood anyway today.
That's exactly right. I mean, essentially, when they were drawing down Lake Darling, they were trying to create a little bit of storage for the ability to take on some of this water from Minot. Now, I do know that they were trying to make it possible that we could increase the flows to a point gradually more so than having an inundation of water coming into Minot. But the reality of the situation is that today is the day that Minot is going to flood. And realizing that we wanted ample time to raise up some of our levee systems and things like that, Lake Darling in our last check was releasing 8,000 CFS in attempt to try to mitigate because the Dalak River was also coming in at a much higher flow from that rainfall than we had ever hoped for. So Lake Darling was releasing at 8,000 CFS. We'll have to keep an eye now on that Lake Darling reading because we're trying to draw it down to that 1597 level. And within this reading, I mean, you take a look at this sharp curve now within this line. It's not only heading, it's already past major flood level. But within a very short time today, we are going to far surpass that record stage of 25 feet.
Now, you know, when you look at this a couple of different ways, on one hand, since, you know, using the phrase, I mean, today's the day that Minot floods, and it looks to be roughly 7 o'clock tonight. Now, that could change. A levee could fail. I mean, there's anything could happen. But right now, looking at the hydrograph, it should be roughly 7 o'clock in Minot. This really doesn't change that since we're going to, you know, we should flood today. But it seems to me that what could change would be the time we get the highest number. I mean, I could see that being impacted, but that doesn't change anything today.
And with the amount of flows that are coming in, as we're seeing right now, I think that's going to be something of contention what the Weather Service maybe is going to change what the flows come into Minot, because certainly that Lake Darling will have to adjust those flows. I mean, they are going to, at the latest projections, increase those flows to 20,000 CFS on the 28th of June. Now, that may be a little bit sooner if, in fact, this water is coming a lot quicker than what they had originally planned for. Now, these are the flows that the Rafferty, Alameda, and Boundary Reservoir have been releasing for 4 days, and it is just now coming into the readings here at Sherwood. It takes about 4 days to reach from those dams down to Sherwood. We'll be keeping our eyes on those projections from Lake Darling when those numbers start to go up, and those numbers then will then thus be adjusted for the readings at Minot, the bridge out just northwest of Minot, and then so on down the line.
And right now, you know, we're just trying to figure this out. When the hydrologists get in later this morning, the Corps of Engineers, I mean, there may be some different answers, but right now that just kind of seems what's going to be happening. Now, something that has happened a couple of times throughout the night, because of, and this is what we think, because of so many people trying to watch our streaming video, sometimes it kind of overloads the system a little bit, because we're getting posts from Hawaii, from California, from Louisiana, from Minnesota, people all logging on. So sometimes it's a little more difficult to get into the, to see the sky cams, webcams that we have. So, you know, that does happen from time to time. Now, are we going to go back to the map?
Let's go back to the evacuation zone map. I want to point out once again these secondary dikes. If we can zoom down in basically between that 4 and 5, and then 6 and 9 area, and we can kind of show once again what we were talking about with those secondary dikes. I think that's a good area right there.
Before you start, can I say one thing?
Absolutely.
This would be a really good time for those of you Facebooking. If you have questions, I'm not saying we can get to every single one of them, but now's the time to put them on Facebook. Shaun will be in front of the weather board there. And, you know, if you have, if we can figure it out, we'll show you where it is on the map. So go ahead and.
Okay,
and
so what we're trying to show here is basically the line where that secondary levee is going to be built to make an attempt to protect the Broadway Bridge. And essentially, the best way where we can tell you is the Broadway Bridge is that line between 4 and 5. We can see that red line right here. This is Broadway right here. The bridge is essentially right here, and it follows up the line. Now, that secondary levee that was built on that first round of when those evacuations were issued, they went to the secondary levee systems, and I'm going to point here. Okay, we've got 3rd Street that follows right next to the red line. So we go to 3rd Street, and it runs just parallel with Broadway. This is where they built that secondary levee, right down the middle of the street. There have been a lot of people that haven't been able to access the front of their homes for a good number of weeks because of that secondary levee. They never took it down. They've actually just increased the height of it a little bit. That levee is going to continue on right down here where the Barley Pop would be at, right in here. And it follows down right underneath the viaduct, the Broadway Bridge, which is right here, which is crossing the river. So it goes underneath the viaduct and wraps around and meets up with Railway Avenue. And that follows up and around basically into evacuation zone number 6 and follows Railway Avenue up into this area. So in essence, it is protecting part of 6. So this is the area that is behind the secondary levee, all of this area, all of number 9, and then portions of number 5, essentially just to the north of where it follows the viaduct around and wraps around on 4th Avenue by Sammy's Pizza. So it meets up with 4th Avenue and then over to Railway Avenue. So this portion of 5 would be protected, just a tiny sliver in section 4 that would be protected from that as well.
Well, we've got a couple of requests here. One of them is 11th Avenue Northeast, and the other would be 9th Avenue Northeast. Now, I will point out that 11th Avenue Northeast, it's Robert. I'm guessing he's like my neighbor because I'm on 12th Avenue Northeast. I know I'm safe, but if you want to show where 11th Avenue Northeast, it kind of gives you perspective on how to read the map, because that is, it's difficult to lock yourself onto that one.
If you see 1555-02 on your screen, 11th Avenue Northeast, and what was the other part of it?
9th Avenue Northeast. Will that map be okay? Matthew wanted to know that.
Okay, so 11th Avenue Northeast, I have to get my bearings here a little bit.
Well, I'm at 12th, and I mean, I'm way okay.
Yeah, okay, so 11th Avenue Northeast is right up in this area, right up here. 11th Avenue right. Northeast is all the way up on the hill up here. You are far and above beyond protected.
And 9th would be on the north side of University.
And 9th Avenue Northeast is going to be just above evacuation zone number 9, so we've got right up in this area for 9th Avenue Northeast.
Can you point out Minot State?
Minot State University, essentially this big area that has nothing in it. This is all Minot State University up in here. You would have Old Main, you would have some of the dormitories up in here, you'd have the MSU Dome, and all of this area right up here is Minot State University. So you'd have University Avenue here. I have to go back to my screen. I apologize for keep turning around, but University Avenue is essentially this red line right here. University Avenue. So you can see the inundation map. The part in blue is the area where at the elevation of 1562, when the river reaches that level, this is the area. Everything in blue is the area where they think where the water is going to be at. Now you can see that there is water outside of what they call the proverbial evacuation map. And what we were talking about, Tom, is that maybe at those elevations, because as you drive up past University, you actually gain elevation. You're going higher than what the river level would be at, or river is at. So when you gain elevation, that means the water isn't going to raise as high. And I could probably talk with some of the Corps of Engineers a little later today, or maybe we can address that on why some of the inundation maps aren't within those evacuation zones. My best guess, and I say guess, best guess would be that that water may reach up into some of those areas, but maybe not at a level that would even be more than curb high. I don't know that specifically, but you can see University Avenue is right here, and then Minot State University is going to be up in this area. You've got Nubbin Park. I'm not sure if a lot of people are familiar with that, but you would be familiar with Oak Park right in this general area in here. And then you've got the Oak Park Shopping Center. The easiest way, 16th Street follows the Mouse River, the Souris River right in here. So you've got the Oak Park Shopping Center. Harley's Amoco is going to be right down in here. We saw a video of them earlier today that were being evacuated. On Central Avenue, there's a picture on Facebook from First International Bank that's going to be right here on Central that they were trying to sandbag and save as well. So what else do we have? We've got
there's
a couple.
Four different places.
Okay, so the Holiday Inn, I'm going to turn.
And you know, I'll throw one here from Facebook, Medical Arts, where you know a lot of doctors are at. That's across, because that's where my doctor is. And okay. That would be, Medical Arts would be on Burdick.
Burdick Express, and you're talking substantially higher on the hill. When we talk about Burdick Expressway and South Broadway, this is the area right as they're moving the map. I'm going to walk towards it. This is Burdick and Broadway right here. I'm sorry, not Burdick. Yes, this is South Broadway. So you've got Burdick and Broadway. This is the big stoplight that we all pass through many times a day. We just follow Burdick down, and Main Street is, and I cannot see a thing on that, so I'm going to have to turn here. Main Street is going to be right here. So you've got Burdick Expressway and Main Street. You're talking about Trinity Hospitals right
Pine
in this
Drive.
Section. And then you just follow that, and you've got the Medical Arts on the hill higher than Burdick is. So all of this area in here is higher on the hill. Not going to be an issue with any of the evacuation counts. A Holiday Inn in Holiday Inn Riverside, and then Burdick Expressway East.
Is the Holiday Inn in number 6, or is it outside it?
It's actually, I want to say it is on number 7.
Oh, 7, okay.
Number 7. It's going to be in the bottom corner here. I'll ask them to zoom down just a little bit. Basically, just follow Burdick Expressway, and we all know where the State Fair is at, North Dakota State Fair, up in here. Here's Burdick Expressway right in here, so the Holiday Inn is going to be right in this section along with the Ground Round. You've got Souris. Souris Drive down right in here in number 7. So you've got the Holiday Inn that's going to be up in this area in the Ground Round, the State Fair Center.
So, dumb question of the day. What happens to the Holiday Inn, to everybody that's there, when it's a mandatory evacuation?
I think that's a good question. We're going to have to address those issues a little bit later. 28th Street and 2nd Avenue Southwest. We're trying to find our homes now. I will try to find the Jefferson Trailer Court here in just a moment. I'm not 100% familiar where that's at in the back of my mind. I'll have to search.
Yeah, somebody might want to post that, because I think it's over off 27th, but I'm not 100%
that does
sure
sound
on that.
Right. 27th Avenue, and we're talking Southwest. Can we pan zoom over into sections 1 and 2 again for me in the control room, please? We'll see if we can find 2nd Avenue Southwest and 28th Street. And I have to look at this HD. That's why I'm standing off to the side. The monitor that I'm looking at is a little bit tough to read.
You want to just get the phone book and just start at the A's? And...
Okay, 28th Street is we're looking at all the way over into into zone 2.
And he's finding it right now. If you're watching at home or on the on a streaming video here, he's finding it on the HD set, which you can't point to on the air because there's such a delay.
Yeah, okay, so we're all the way over into Zone 3, and actually, if you're looking for 28th Street and 2nd Avenue Southwest, you're right here within Zone 1. This is going to be the area that you're talking about right in here. So you're in zone three all the way over here. That's your area. The Milton Young Towers, excuse me, we have to dig all the way back over into, and I've got to get my bearings here. If we find Burdick Expressway, which is that main line between 4 and 5, there we go, and we work over onto 20th.
We're getting quite a few here. It's going to take a little bit.
Okay, so Milton Young Towers, Burdick Expressway is right here, South Broadway. The Milton Young Towers are actually going to be all the way over into this big section right in here. You're far and above on the hill.
Also, Jefferson, Shaun, is on 31st Avenue, 31st Street Southeast.
31st Street Southeast. So we're actually going to have to dig all the way over into Section 8, I believe. Okay, so you said 31st. I'm getting a number of requests here. So you said 31st.
Yeah.
Okay, 31st Street Southeast. I've got 31st. What's the other location on that, Tom?
It just says 31st Street Southeast.
Okay.
And do you know where the Gold Nugget Court is? Because I guess that's...
Well, let me show you 31st. 31st is actually going to be right in here. Yep. Okay, so this is the Jefferson Trailer Court right in here.
Okay, so they're right at the edge.
That's right at the edge. And if you see that there's actually a little area that is separated, and I'm not sure what all that has to do with. This is also the area over by Public Works, if I'm not mistaken, on 31st. So that would be a good question as to calling the flood information hotline at 858-9366. To go that route. Country Club Acres, that's all the way over. If we do a full zoom out, that might be the best way to point over to Country Club Acres. It's west of town. It's basically in the subdivisions far beyond, I think, because we talk about the bypass, which is all the way out here, and this is the farthest this map reaches. You may actually have to go to the county's website to find that out. So you're talking about an area, and I'm pointing off screen, that's over in that area, and I don't know if we have the county's website or not.
Need to point something out here. People that are watching on SD sets, which there are still a few around.
Yes.
Actually, on this TV over here, Shaun, there's some tape that I've hung.
Okay.
For doing weather.
Okay.
If you're outside that tape, they can't see what
they
you're talking about.
They can't see me. Okay. So when I'm pointing here, you don't see me on the SD sets.
You don't. I mean, you can tell over here if you're outside the tape. So that's also something we're going to need to let the control room know.
Okay.
That we're going to need to move the picture a little bit farther in towards the center.
Do me a favor, Mike, and zoom all the way over into Zone 8 again. We'll identify Jefferson Trailer Court. We've had a lot of questions about that. I'll try to get that within that SD 4x6 format here. I apologize for that, for not remembering. We've got these nice big 16x9 big monitors here that I'm trying to maneuver my way around here.
You know, okay. And most people could see it, but if you have an oversight,
and go down just a little bit, it's right below the Minot River level is actually right on top of the area of Jefferson Trailer Court on 31st Street Southeast. There we go. This little white box right in here, this is the area where we were talking about for Jefferson Trailer Court. So that's we've had many questions on in the evacuation zone. So you can see you might actually be outside of Zone 8, but you're still within the inundation map at 1562. Our projected forecast is actually for 1563. Maybe if you want to do a full zoom out again, Mike, here, I apologize for bouncing all around. We'll try to get these as orderly. I just want to kind of give a few indications. Let's do some landmark adjustments here when we talk about the different evacuation zones. Again, I'll point out Oak Park. That seems to be an area of big reference because it does take up quite a bit of an area. The Oak Park area with the shopping center, Harley's, Amoco. We've got, and I apologize, I'm probably going to have to step off screen here a little bit every now and again. We've got Minot State University up in this area. Ramstead Middle School is in this area right in here that they've been, I believe, shoring up or attempting to put up a big ring dike around that as well. And then up in here, we've got the Roosevelt Park Zoo that's going to be right in this area. Roosevelt Park follows this line. We've got the State Fair Center right in this area. And along with that, then, this is Burdick Expressway that follows 7 and 8. I'm going to try to stay within this 4x6 area and then the Holiday Inn and Ground Round within section number 7. And let's see here if I can jump out and do any more identifying areas that might help people out here a little bit. I'll try to point out if I can jump down and see Main Street again. Main Street in Minot is going to be, we've got Burdick Expressway right in here. We've had a lot of questions about Trinity Hospital and that area. Main Street is right here, right where that cursor is following my finger. Thank you, Mike.
And there has been some confusion. Trinity Hospital and Trinity Nursing Home. People hear the word Trinity and automatically think that it's the hospital when they have already evacuated Trinity Nursing Home.
So that is correct.
There was some confusion earlier today about that.
Okay, so the hospital's on the hill or is on the side of the hill. That's not an area of concern. For the nursing home, let's...
Now, that's already been evacuated.
That's already been evacuated, but let's go ahead and zoom down. I believe that's in number 5. If memory serves correct, we'll zoom down in there, and that's right on
third.
Thank you. On 5, I can
third Street is over the bridge north between 3rd Street and the airport.
Okay, so basically, no, it's actually within the area that could very well be protected. We've got 2nd Street, which is kind of the separation between 5, 6, and 9. Right here, and here's 3rd Street. So this is going to be the area of Trinity Nursing Home. So as we talked about, and I'll follow this one more time, and then we'll probably take a break and go back to a little bit of different information here. So this is the nursing home area. We're talking about that secondary dike system they're trying to build up, and this is why we started this whole thing of jumping out in front of the board. This is Broadway between 4 and 5 on this red line. 3rd Street is where they put up this secondary dike right in here, and that follows all the way down to the viaduct underneath the bridge, and it wraps around to 3rd Avenue. Some people think it's 4th Avenue. It's Sammy's Pizza. It actually does turn into 4th Avenue eventually, into Sammy's Pizza, and then it follows Railway Avenue.
And now, you and I have had that conversation before, because at Sammy's Pizza, the sign says 4th Avenue if you're heading east.
That's right.
But it's actually 3rd.
And it says 3rd if you're heading west.
Right.
And it turns into 4th after you go over the bridge by Oak Park and wraps around and then becomes 4th.
Right. Okay.
Okay, so it follows Railway Avenue. This is the secondary dike system all the way down here. So again, this is the area that is going to be protected by that secondary dike. And again, this part right here, north on 5, and then just a sliver within 4th. That's the area that's going to be on 2nd Country Club Acres. Again, I'm not able with this map to show Country Club Acres. It's far to the west over here on that inundation map. To get the best idea, we'll see if we can bring that up on the county's website here in just a little bit. We may actually have to go and find another map within our control room to be able to show that. So are there any other quick questions here, Tom?
No, I'm just going to point out something that when we came up with this, and I'm not sure if it was you. This actually might have been your idea, so I'm going to pass this one on. The idea to have you stand in front of the board seems to be a pretty big hit. And I got to tell you, I was having trouble. You were pointing these things out all day. I was having trouble myself trying to, you know, see where things were, and you standing in front really helped. And so Erica Copeland says you deserve an Emmy for that.
I might hold you to that one. So I appreciate that, and we may end up doing this again here a little bit.
We're going to move on to something a little bit different. Yep,
on to that. We've got many hours to kill here yet. We'll take a short break here, Mike. We're going to come back in just a few moments, and we'll do an update. We'll check on river levels to see if they've changed much. We'll readdress that issue up by Sherwood. And as a matter of fact, we also want to touch on Perry's package, talking about the evacuations that ran earlier tonight. Any one last thing, Tom?
And before we break away for commercials, Mike, this will be a good time for those of you that are on Facebook right now to ask us your questions. Right now, we're going to kind of move away from using this map. So if you have different questions, maybe we'll come back to this a little bit later. Because, Shaun, you and I still have just under 3 hours before Perry and Joe take over.
That's right. Before we go to break, though, I think what we need to do is we need to take a look at Burlington, too. After the break, okay, we've got to take a few minutes to do that, so we'll leave these cameras set up. We'll take a look at Burlington, because there's a lot of folks that we haven't addressed over there
We can use the same type of map for Burlington.
Absolutely.
There
we'll do that, and we'll be back in just a couple of moments. We'll send it to CBS, and we'll continue our live coverage for Flood Flight 2011 in just a few moments.
From KX News in high definition, this is a special report, Flood Fight 2011.
And good morning, and thanks for staying up with us on this early morning hours. It is 15 minutes past the hour of 3 o'clock. I'm Shaun Sipma, in with meteorologist Tom Schrader and a great many other folks here with KX News. Mike Heilman, Bob Berger, we've got
Piper Jones
and
Stephanie Waldrop.
Stephanie Waldrop helping answer phones and helping us.
She put together a little video book. That we showed earlier, and we had something here that we're going to talk about later today. Danielle asked us if maybe after this is all done, we can come up with some kind of documentation, maybe a DVD or something, and sell it and send the money to the Red Cross or somebody. So something we can check into.
Absolutely. As we look at, basically, it is the historic day for the Magic City and for the city of Burlington. As you pointed out earlier, Tom, today is the day that Minot floods. It's not a matter of if now, it's a matter of when. And right now we're marching on. If we take a look at our latest numbers here, that we're at 1555.02 on Minot.
We should have a new number in about 6 or 7 minutes.
6 or 7 minutes. So we have peaked at that 50, we have reached rather that 1555 mark, marching towards that historic crest level that was achieved in 1969 during that flood at 1555.4.
That's probably going to happen midday.
If the river levels continue on their current course, absolutely. Now, what we're looking at here, we've decided to bring up some of these maps and evacuation zones to try to give you an idea of exactly where we're talking about when we reference these different towns. We've been talking about Minot here for the last little while. And now we've brought up Burlington. Certainly, we didn't want to leave anybody out behind when we talk about the evacuation zones. And the best references, I'm very familiar with Minot. I will do my best in Burlington. I've been driving around that area for a good number of weeks now and have become very familiar with this area right in here. This is the Ball Diamonds down in the Burlington River Road area, I believe. And if memory serves correct, we see the Dalak River that flows right in through here. And that area of issue, a few weeks back when they noticed there was some erosion, it was essentially a dike system right in this area that was having a little bit of issue that came in and made a secondary dike in here to help shore that up. And that seemed to have been, has been working. And right now the Dalak River has kind of roared back to life and has brought back some immediacy in the flood fight in Burlington. They are continuing to sandbag around the clock in attempt to save Burlington from the Mouse River and from the Mouse River. All the way over here we have Parkway Drive, and that's all the way over here on the far end of our screen. We can see there. Now this area in the orange, all this area in the orange is the mandatory evacuation, and that goes into effect noon today. Now on this screen, it's a little hard to see. It's a little light, little lighter green color. We can see right in here. It's basically everything on the other side of the. My pointing skills
is
terrible.
Is that road into Burlington?
This is the main road in Burlington, right here. You can see it following up right along here. It's the main road in Burlington, and that is Johnston Street. That is the edge of the recommended evacuation zone. Johnston Street is the one that is right through here, we can see. And then we've also got Railway Avenue, which is right in here, which is inside that recommended evacuation zone. Now, what separates the recommended from the mandatory, as we take a look at that, that is Davis Street. That's the cut line. It goes from Davis Street and Kitty Corners down to Parkway Drive. And on the east side of Davis Street and Parkway Drive, you have the mandatory evacuation zone that goes into effect noon today. And then you've got the recommended, which includes all of Railway Avenue and areas from Johnson Street to Davis. So you can see that there literally is just a line in the road, and that has to do with the elevation. The elevation makes all the difference, because anybody who's driven in Burlington knows as you go up, even Valley, I believe that's Valley Street right there, or Valley Avenue rather. If you drive up Valley Avenue from the ballpark, you're actually driving uphill. That makes all the difference when we talk about water that's going to be flooding. And as it floods and you drive uphill, obviously it's not going to get as deep, and at some point it will be that literally the line that makes all the difference. Colton Avenue, we've been hearing a lot about Colton Avenue and the bridge that has been closed, and I apologize. Maybe we can zoom just a little farther now because we're off of the screen for some of the folks that have the
regular old TV sets.
The old TV sets. That's the easiest way. Okay, it's right here. This is Colton Avenue. When we've talked about that bridge that was closed, that's located right here on Colton Avenue.
You're close
Avenue.
To the edge there, too, Shaun.
Yep, we're right on the edge here. This is my line for the old sets right here on this road.
Okay.
So this is the Colton Avenue Bridge, and we've got a number of the other businesses, and I apologize. I believe that one of these is a car wash over here. I apologize if I can't remember the exact businesses that are over here, but that's kind of the indication there. And then Cherry Street is in the bottom of the screen right in here. And turning into Burlington, obviously, then you would hit the road all the way down here. And that's the one that takes you to the ballpark, and that's River Road that I was referencing earlier. We've got Cherry Street, Plum Drive, Willow Street, Elm Street, all located down in this area. And to give you an idea, when we talked about the battle to sandbag to save Burlington, this is the levee system that they're working on. This is the Mouse River levee system. It's certainly an extensive system when you talk about trying to raise an entire levee system a couple of feet. So this is the entire area that they've been working on and sandbagging round the clock, trying to raise that enough to try and save the town.
I just want to be sure, because I'm imagining there's still some people working in Burlington right now sandbagging. If there's somebody there, an official, do you still need sandbaggers in Burlington? Because I think we're running into the top of the screen, but we haven't heard from them in a while.
So I haven't heard, and maybe somebody can actually call into the KX studios here. We do have people answering the phone round the clock right now. The last we were told, and this came from the Public Works Director in Burlington, and his indication was they were not going to stop sandbagging at any point. They were going to continue sandbagging until the river itself, the Mouse River, became so unsafe that it pushed them off the levees. So they're sandbagging around the clock. They had two of those automatic sandbagging machines. If you've ever seen them, it's quite a phenomenal little invention, where a large payloader will dump sand into the hopper, and you've got two different areas where you basically put the bag up underneath the bagger, you press a button, and it's automatically geared, or you can put a pound on there or a little measurement that it automatically fills the bag to the exact amount every time. And you can kick them out one after another. It's quite the machine.
I have a question for you from Heather. Does this include as far would be east, I guess, of the Boy Scout Ranch? Is that going to be on this map, or
Boy Scout
is
Ranch,
this just the city of Burlington?
Let's zoom out on this. I'm not sure how far we can go on some of these maps.
So that's not really going to show.
No, unfortunately, we don't have, and we may have to do a little more research, and I apologize. We've been trying to locate some of the Ward County maps, and I do know that they are on the Ward County webpage. You can see that some of the areas outside of Burlington, and they show the line that stops right here. That it's a little bit deceptive, because this is just for the city of Burlington. Now, there are areas that are also under the mandatory evacuations that go into effect noon today. And a lot of these areas are all along the Mouse River. All of the subdivisions, Terracita, Vallejo, already had the evacuation that came in today. And then the Brooks Addition and areas like that, noon today is that line. Can we zoom up just a little bit? I want to head up to City Hall here, Mike. I'm sure you're very familiar with where that's at here. Okay, the new City Hall is essentially, and I'm fairly certain I'm correct on here, it's up here. It's where they're doing a lot of the sandbagging. This is actually where the I believe that new apartment complex was put in not too long ago. And then we have City Hall. This is where they're doing a lot of the sandbagging with us. Up to the right? Okay, this is City Hall right up in here. That's where they've been doing the sandbagging. Somebody asked where you want to volunteer. This is the main road that comes into Burlington, so you would actually just be almost on your way out of Burlington. There's just a little street right there you can turn onto, and that's, I believe, it's so, I can't even read it, actually, but if you're looking for Wallace Street, Wallace Street is where that City Hall is located. 1555.08, so we've gone up another 0.2 inches on the Mouse River and Minot as some of those new readings are coming in. Do we need to spend any more time on the Burlington map, Tom?
I'm not getting any questions from Burlington right now. You know, it's a small enough community that the people who live there pretty much know what's going on.
And keep in mind, too, as we look at this, again, this is the Burlington map, but you also have areas outside of Burlington, and you know, the areas that we're talking about, because you've probably been dealing with water for a substantial amount of time. This is the confluence where the Dalax meets the Mouse right here. And then as the Mouse wraps around, these are also the areas that have been battling water for a number of weeks. And that is also in some of the areas that are under those mandatory evacuations come noon today. Maybe we could flip back quickly, and I can attempt to find the Robindale trailer court here that somebody had called into right before we took that last break, and I will do my best. I've got an idea in my head where it's at. I just need to, get down into sections number 7 and 8 in the evacuation zones and take a look at that. Okay, so we've got the State Fair Center. I'll wait for him to quit zooming down here before I continue here. You may have to go up just a little bit. There we go.
And possibly move that into the center of the screen a little bit more if you could.
Yep. Oh yeah. I got to remember the old television
sets. The old TV
sets.
Thank you.
This is good enough, actually. They should be able to identify. Okay, again, this is the State Fair Center here in Minot, or actually it's property within Ward County. So you've got Burdick Expressway, which is right here. And then from there, the road is 27th Street Southeast, which is also County Road 9 for anybody, and that's in this area right here. You're talking about the Robindale Trailer Court. That's going to be in this area in section number 8, right here in that area in number 8. And again, for anybody else watching, you've got Souris Drive right in here. You've got the Holiday Inn, the State Fair Center up here, and so on up down the line. From that point, Tom, are there any other more quick questions?
No, that's it for questions that for the maps. That is it. I don't see anything else.
I think at this point what we should do, maybe, Mike, if we want to load that virtual tour that Jim Olson put together, let's go ahead and run that. It was kind of a walkthrough this morning as Jim was out and about kind of touring the areas where they were doing work. He does make one reference, though, that about 9 feet above that 69 flood level. That was before the revision when the initial crest came out at 1564.4. That has been revised down to 1563, so instead of being 9 feet above the 69 flood level, it's 8 feet. We're talking about 1 foot in a massive flood level, but if you're ready, go ahead and roll that. This gives a good idea of what work looked like this morning in and around Minot.
Well, this is my tour at about 8 a.m. on the 21st, the first day of summer. We're here at the East Burdick Bridge, one of the bridges that will be closing before too long, and you can see the work that's going on here. You can also see the level of the river up at the bridge level. Right now, the river is at the height that it reached as a crest back on the 1st of June. So we're at the same spot that we were 3 weeks ago. There's a look at the downstream side of the bridge. You can see how the water is just kind of squirting out from underneath the bridge. It seems like it wouldn't be too much higher before this particular bridge will have to be closed down to traffic. In the distance, we can see some of the work that's going on to build up the diking around some of the critical infrastructure. And we'll go over to that side of the bridge now and show you some of that. Here's what it looks like on the upstream side of the bridge. Still here, standing right beside the Roosevelt Park Zoo. I'll just pan over there so you can see that. And you can see how the river is hitting the bottom of the bridge right now and just kind of threatening to get up just slightly onto the walkway right alongside the bridge. There is one of the infrastructure sites in the city being protected by very high dikes. As I walk across the bridge now, you can see where the water is just starting to kind of inch its way up onto the walkway. So at this 1554.07 level, it's very close to getting up onto the deck of the bridge. This is the site of a lift station right along East Burdick, right across from the zoo. And I'm using Brecken right here from the work crew to demonstrate for us about how high 9 feet is. He's standing up on top of that phone box there, or whatever that is, that we figure is about 3 feet high. He's about 6 feet tall, so that's 9 feet high. So I hope you can get the idea. That's how much higher than the 1969 flood we're expecting this to be. I'm still at the East Burdick Bridge. See, traffic is somewhat heavy. It's not real bad right now. But this just kind of gives you a shot from an area that we've shot video from here before. And you get an idea of how high the water is. There's a house that I've shot in the past to show you how close it is to the top of the dike. All right, we're at a new location now. That's the Memorial Bridge. I guess what we used to know as the 8th Street Bridge in Northwest Minot. And you can get a look at how the water is right up to the deck of that as well. And again, we're sitting probably right now at this minute, probably just a little above what the crest was 3 weeks ago. And again, remember that we're expecting to go, according to the last projection from the National Weather Service, 10 feet higher than what the water is right now. Actually, 10 and a half feet higher than what the water is right now. So if we look at that white house over there, we see what the level of the water is now. We add 10 feet to that. I would estimate that that is going to put it somewhere maybe halfway up that chimney you see on the left side over there. Certainly onto the chimney, maybe not halfway, but it'll be up that chimney if it goes as high as they say. There's the 6th Street Bridge, the bridge that was closed briefly a few weeks ago when they thought maybe it had shifted a bit under the pressure of the water. They determined later that it wasn't a problem and reopened it. Of course, it will be closed sometime in the near future, in the next couple of days, as the water rises. So with the water running the way it is right now and the prediction from the Weather Service being that we'll add another 10 and a half feet to this level, you can figure that this river road sign that you see right there is going to be maybe peeking out of the top of the water, pretty much right at the top of the water, I'd say.
Hey, tell me your name.
Sergeant Levi Jensen.
Hi, Sergeant. Where are you from?
Born and raised in Minot, actually.
All right. So tell me what the job is here right now.
Right now, they're moving a lot of material, trying to build up, protect the main city infrastructure right now. We're blocking off one of the main thoroughfares for the trucks, letting them through, making sure they can get to those sites and, you know, protect as much as they can.
Important to you. You've lived here your whole life. You know what it's
exactly.
Like here.
Exactly. And, you know, it's just terrible. I mean, we went through one evacuation already. Now we're on the second one. And, you know, everybody's scrambling again. I mean, communities are still pulling together. You know, everybody's seems like they're keeping a pretty good attitude. But it's tough. It's really tough. I mean, you're already been enough damage for this already. And it's just battles just keeps going.
And there's more to come, unfortunately.
Yeah, right now that's the way it's looking. Yeah. I mean, fingers crossed, hopefully all goes well, so.
All right. Well, thanks for your help here. We appreciate it.
Hey, not a problem.
All right.
Tell me your name.
My name is Benjamin Clark from Minnesota.
Benjamin, did you say?
Benjamin.
What's your rank?
Specialist E4.
All right, and how long you been? You're from Minneapolis, but you train with the Guard here in North Dakota.
I do train here with the Guard in North Dakota.
And so, how long
I'm from
you been
Minneapolis.
Here?
I've been here in Minot for the flood duty since May 23rd, and I'm hoping to leave, but probably not. And
what have your jobs been?
I'm a chaplain assistant here in the military, but as of jobs here, I've gone everywhere from all the way in Burlington all the way to Burdick Street, Minot here with dike watching. I've also done just some of the TCPs here within the past few days, and that's about it from what I can remember.
It's been a long few weeks, huh?
Yes, it has been.
Ready to get home?
I'm very ready to get home.
Well, thanks for your help.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Have a great day.
Well, I guess you'd call this a hotbed of activity right now because there are all kinds of trucks moving around here. Here comes one of those Bechtold paving trucks right now, bringing in another load of clay and heading out somewhere. And you can see here at the water treatment plant, there is a large dike that's going up to protect the water treatment plant itself. It's going up in the parking lot just to the north of the building. There's a good example right there. A couple of those great big side dumping loaders there, hauling clay off to another site to try to protect. Here's a better look at the dike work that's going on just north of the water treatment plant. You get the idea of just how high they're building those dikes when you see that big loader go down the side of the dike. National Guard members, like the ones we talked to there, are out in force around Minot. I believe the number is up to about 350 now who are helping out around town and throughout Ward County. There's the top of this dike that is on the north side of the water treatment plant. Now let's look down the river just a little bit here from the 16th Street Bridge area. You can see just how close we're getting to the top of the dike in some of these spots. As I zoom in there, you get a pretty good look at it right there of how close we are in that area off to the left side of the screen right there. And of course, the news that we learned on Monday is that there will be no more work done on these main dikes, the what you would call the primary levees, the emergency levees that have been built up over the past several weeks around the town of Minot. A little bit of variation there from the height on that side of the dike or that side of the river to that side of the river. So the folks on that left side are going to see the water before the folks on the right side. Quite a scene here. There's an XL Energy truck going by. We just saw one of those side dump trucks, and a more traditional dump truck is getting ready to come by. Well, actually, it's turning and going down the road here. It's just one after another. These trucks are moving through town, and that's why, of course, they're asking everyone to make sure that you stay off the roads if you don't have to be out on the roads, and certainly make sure you pay attention to the folks who are wearing the yellow vests, the National Guard, and the police, or directing traffic to make sure the trucks get through as quickly as possible. So that's the end of my travelogue for you this morning, taken on Tuesday morning between 8 and about 9 o'clock or so, and a few of the spots along the river that might be of interest to you to see how things are going around town. Over the next couple of days, we expect a fairly slow but steady rise in the level of the Mouse River through Minot. Perhaps as early as sometime on Thursday night, we could see Friday morning, we could see the water start to go over the top of dikes in some areas. And then certainly the river will start to dramatically go higher after that. And we're told that it is a certainty that the water will be pouring over dikes all over the valley throughout the city of Minot. Jim Olson, KX News.
Again, we just want to reiterate that that was shot this morning before some of those revisions were made. The initial evacuation was going to be 10 o'clock tonight.
Tonight, later on tonight.
That has actually been mitigated down now to 6 o'clock tonight. And even Mayor Kurt Zimmelman had indicated that they could anticipate an evacuation call even before that if there is a breach. Which could come depending on the rise of the river level. It's only been going up 0.2 of an inch about every hour from what we've seen over the last couple of hours, but that certainly could change because of the flows coming in from the Dulac and from the Mouse and so on.
Now, do you have the hydrograph for the Broadway Bridge there on your computer?
I can grab it right
here. And we're
here.
Going to be doing the river levels. Or actually, I think Mike wanted to show the radar here. And it's kind of behind me, so Mike Heilman was picking up on this. I kind of forgot about it. There's another band of rain. It's not terribly heavy, but it's kind of stretching from Bottineau County through central McHenry County down through McLean County. So, you know, rain around Rugby and some showers around Harvey up to Bottineau. And that is kind of edging its way towards Minot. So, you know, we may get a few more rain showers in the Magic City here a little bit later on this morning. So that's that with the radar right now. And, of course, we'll have a complete update on the weather this morning on KX News Morning with Perry and Joe.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how about the Minot hydrograph that you're looking at there?
The hydrograph that I'm looking at continues. I mean, we have now reached into the area which is considered a major flood stage for the Mouse River, and the current level is 1558.08. And now
we have a couple of numbers now that won't, so people aren't confused, because we addressed this a little bit earlier. There's a number that we're going to hit today, possibly in the midday hours, that would be the same number as 1969. That's not a flood for us yet, but that just shows you where we're at compared to 1969.
Yeah, as long as all of the temporary levees hold, essentially 1554 is the magic number for that 69. That was the top of the water level that was reached in the 69 flood.
So now, that's midday, and that's probably not flooding unless something bad happens.
Unless there is a break in one of the levee systems, that will still be contained within our dike system. Now, we are getting to the point, though, that a lot of the low spots and things like that are only getting to the point of 1 foot of freeboard. And freeboard, I apologize when I don't continue or when I don't explain some of this. Freeboard on a levee system is the distance from the top of the river to the top of the dike, the ground that's between the river and the top of the dike. So that is called freeboard, that distance right in there.
Okay, so the number, the top of the dike is where?
The top of the dike, the goal
most
of
everywhere.
The Corps of Engineers was to get all of Minot up to 1556.
Okay.
That is the final flow from
Minot's
dike.
And that's without any
system.
Freeboard. That's the physical top of
that
the dike.
That is the physical top of the dike, and that's when they say when it reaches that level, it is going to start pouring over the dikes.
So now that we've established that, what do you see on the Minot hydrograph? So if looking at the hydrograph using the numbers that are in there right now, and they may crunch these things, well, they will re-crunch these numbers later on this morning. Will this happen today? And the reason we've talked about this, but we're getting people watching us in the Netherlands, in Hawaii, a lot of different states. So we're just trying to keep everybody up to date here. Is this still going to happen today?
It is going to happen today. All indications right now, and I was looking at 000 thinking, and you had to correct me on this earlier, it's a little different time than just military time on here. There's a couple of numbers that are a little bit creating a little bit of disparity for me here, because it was our understanding that our dike system was built to handle 10,000 CFS. That was the idea, 10,000 CFS. However, that number is achieved at right around 1555.7. That is 10,000 CFS according to this number. However, they're saying 1559.9 is 10,000.2. So I think this is where we talked about the river channel that became more efficient and things like that. So it's a little bit difficult to say exactly the time. And I think that's where the mayor was saying there is a lot of uncertainty of exactly when we are going to see this river overflow. According to the National Weather Service, if we just take the hydrograph numbers, they're saying 7 o'clock tonight.
Roughly 7 o'clock tonight.
Roughly 7 o'clock tonight.
When the water will start spilling over.
Essentially an hour after the evacuation goes into the mandatory effect. Now, here's the catch. If there is a low spot and if it breaches, it is going to start flowing in a big-time way throughout the area. Because what happens, and I was listening to the Army Corps of Engineers talk about this during a press conference today, that what happens when the river goes over a temporary levee. Now we're talking about these clay levees that have been brought in with dump trucks and mowed over with dozers and packed only in that sense. What happens is that water starts going over that temporary levee and it's not packed properly really on either side.
Yeah, I mean, they're in a hurry, right?
Well, that's the whole idea of temporary levee. They're not meant for a permanent basis, and they're not meant for water to go over the top. What happens then when it starts going over the top is it destabilizes that entire levee system and starts eroding it. Now, when that erosion starts happening, then you have this temporary levee where the water is going, and it's going to create basically a cut, and that is going to widen out from that point. So wherever it goes, it's going to then increase those flows out of the river into the city of Minot.
Okay, so again, just for those listening, that appears to be roughly 7 o'clock tonight. Could be earlier, could be later. That's provided nothing else bad happens.
And there's also a catch to that, because once the river reaches a level basically getting near the top, that is also an area where they have already talked about that the higher that the water gets on that levee, the more unstable it becomes. So in essence, it may take the water just getting to the top and then overflowing, and then it starts deteriorating the dikes and we have a flood that way. Or the water could get near the top and it destabilizes an area enough where then it breaches the levee. So again,
because
that's why
the top is packed, but the sides aren't.
Mm-hmm.
And so the water could come up on the sides, start eating away here and cave in the top. And then
you just don't know. There's so much uncertainty when you talk about temporary levees that are meant to hold water back for a short while. And that's it. In that case, I mean, that could happen anywhere from, let's say, even the noon hour on, and which is why the mayor was saying, get your stuff worked throughout the night. Get out as soon as you can, because you don't want to wait to the last minute, because it might be too late at that point.
All right. Should we take a look at the river numbers?
Let's go ahead and take a look
okay,
at the river
numbers. Okay, and I'm going to kind of talk you through this here, and we'll start in Sherwood right now. This is actually west of the city of Sherwood. And the latest number is 25.83, and you can see the forecast is 20, I can't read that from here, 26.6. Okay, on June 26th. Now let's go to the latest hydrograph, and I think this actually was from 1:30. And I'm going to describe this for those of you that are listening to the radio right now. A lot of people that are evacuating have already packed away the TV and everything, and so they're listening on WGO or the Zoo, 94.9 the Zoo, listening to a simulcast there. So what we have here on the hydrograph that we're looking at on TV and you're hearing us talk about on the radio is a horizontal line stretching from 3 a.m. and I can't see the bottom of the screen here, but would have been yesterday or the day before, and it's been fairly horizontal for a while, and then just in the past few hours, it's almost like if you can picture an L, writing the letter L, and it makes that much of a turn. It's almost a vertical line up. It's very close to vertical, I'd say about 88 degree turn there. Sometime in the past few hours, and it's now into major flood stage at over 25 feet. And at 2:30, it was at 25-45. And so that is a big rush of water that is moving into Sherwood right now. That's going to be heading down to, make sure I get this right, Shaun, Lake Darling. And then it's going to be coming into Minot. So that we can already see it's happening. The water is coming into from Canada right now. So now that's Sherwood. So now let's go and take a look at the next set of gauges on the map here. Now the Foxhome Delac River, and this has been the wild card for Burlington because there's nothing to stop it. And you know, we had inch and a half rains yesterday in the Delac River, the Delac River Basin. And so right now it's at 1723 and rising. Now the Lake Darling Dam, and it's kind of hard to keep up with all the numbers here on the Lake Darling Dam, but we can tell you that the spillway top, the last numbers we have is 1601.5 feet. Right now it's at 1598.87. That is actually down a little bit, so we're getting a little bit of storage there in Lake Darling. That is all good. It helps buy us at least a little bit of time in Minot. It's kind of the short-term answer for that. Now in Burlington, the Delac River is rising once again. It's at 24.33 and it's expected to hit 24.63. And I'm sure that's not June 2nd. Well, that says the highest. So, because there is no projected crest on that. It's just, it's rising right now, the Delac River. And so there isn't, on the hydrographs that we look at, there is no number there, a second set of numbers. East of Foxhome on the Mouse River, at this point is dropping just a little bit. Now remember, Lake Darling was dropping just a little bit. Foxhome's down to 17.70. However, that's expected to go, you know, over 20 feet to almost 21 feet on June 28th at 20.9. And now as we move to northwest of Minot, the Mouse River, this would be forecast to hit 24.5 on June 28th. Now we've had questions yesterday, and I just want to kind of go over this again and make sure we you know, fully explain this to those of you that might have missed this or are watching us in the Netherlands or Hawaii or whatever. The questions we got a lot yesterday was, why is northwest of Minot only going to go up about 3 feet or so when Minot's Broadway Bridge, which is what, 4 miles away, could go up 7-8 feet. Part of the a major part of this would be in the northwest of Minot, the Boy Scout Bridge, it's outside the dike system, right? And so the water is going to spread out a lot farther. It's not going to rise as much. So the water is going to find all these little low-lying areas. It's going to spread out. So that's why 3 feet. But once you get into Minot, we've got all the dikes around. We've got kind of a bowl system going on here. That's going to keep the water from spreading out nearly as much, and so it's going to rise quite a bit more. Now earlier today, the numbers we were hearing was 1564.4, I believe, and now it's 1563.
Yeah,
so that is certainly some good news. Now there's also the downside to this. Now when Jim Olson was talking with Alan Schlag, the hydrologist from the National Weather Service, he was talking about you know, when they had this 1564.4 number, what they were thinking of is when the water left the dikes, it would be kind of like filling up a fishbowl. or a bathtub. It would just rise. But now when they're crunching these numbers, they're finding out, at least what they're thinking is going to happen, is there's going to be a bit of a current. And that would help evacuate some of the water, hence the lower numbers. Now, that on one hand sounds good. On the other hand, and there's no choice in this, this isn't like they made a choice to do this. On the other hand, if there is a current, that current is going to be flowing through buildings, which could be potentially quite destructive. So we don't know what's going to happen here because, one, this has never happened before to this extent. There are no manuals. There are no charts that deal with these kind of numbers. We're kind of going, you know, going through this as we go. So that's the latest thinking. There's going to be a bit of a current which will help evacuate some of the water. But again, there could be a current going through some buildings, and that would be a different issue here. Now, once we get to Logan, this is where things really jump, Shaun, because earlier today, the number was in the 38, 39 number. I don't remember exactly what it was. And now it looks for Logan's forecast is 41.9. That's a big jump. It's almost like a 3-foot jump, if I remember from what we had earlier. And so as bad as it is in Logan right now at 37.39 feet, it's supposed to go to 41 feet. That's a huge jump in Logan. And now in Sawyer, it's at 24.47, and I think you made the observation while we were in commercial break that everywhere along the Mouse River in North Dakota, I think we're going to set a record everywhere.
If not
an all-time record, right?
There was one reading where I was looking at where it could be a possibility where we may miss it, but every other reading I've looked at has just been far and above, if not already above that record forecast. Sherwood. We have actually already bumped over that record stage. And then we look at Foxholm, we've bumped over that record stage. I think the one was actually at the Boy Scout Bridge that we haven't broke yet, but we're going to.
Okay.
I take that back. I believe the one might even be Velva.
Well, now we're on Velva right now. And the Velva, and there's a lot of numbers, and you and Perry and Jim have been dealing with doing this map more than I have, so I want to be asking you up here. I think Velva was, it's built to handle 15?
Correct.
Okay, and it's forecast to go to 15-11, so at this point, unless something dramatic happens, the city of Velva will be protected.
But I stand corrected on saying that the highest ever was 15.09, so that forecast of 15-11 would be a record.
Okay, that would be a record there. But it appears that Velva would be protected. Now we've gone to Towner on the right side of your map. It's a 56.85 for the current stage. It looks like it's going to go to about 57.3 on June 28th. And then Bantry is a 14.73 feet and expected to go to 15.1 on June 28th. Now we know that this number has got to be wrong, at least it was most of the night, because it's saying that the forecast, and this is what I, when we were looking at these numbers, trying to straighten this out, when I went to the National Weather Service site, the biggest number I could find for a forecast was 19.4. Well, it's over that right now. It's at 19.53 feet in West Hope. So that's something that's going to have to be revisited.
I'm actually looking at the hydrograph right now inside the numbers. It's calling for 19.7 feet.
Okay, so that's
on the
changed.
25th.
Okay, so we can actually change that on the map right now, but we'll do that in just a couple of minutes.
19.7 feet.
Okay, so, and that's West Hope.
I did a walk around through the entire Souris River system, the Souris Moss River system, and it appears that we are going to break each and every record ever set within that Moss River Souris system in North Dakota. I can't speak for Canada, but looking up and down the line, we are going to well surpass, and it's not just by inches, we are talking by several feet.
Now, we've had requests to show the little video postcard that Stephanie put together. Can you talk us through? I think it's like a 45 pictures we pulled off Facebook. And do you still have the notes here?
I actually won't even need the notes. Stephanie was good enough to put all of that information at the bottom of that.
And the control room is a curveball to throw them again. So, yeah. Mike, if you could find that little video postcard that has the 45 pictures in it, Shaun will take them through that, and I'll fix the West Hope gauge here.
All right.
Information.
I'll grab these just in case here. We've got a good number of pictures, and this one starts off at right in Minot. It's one of the National Guards by Minot State University sent in from Brandy. She submitted quite a few onto our Facebook. Brandy Shar doing a good job of helping traffic throughout the entire town, like some of these trucks that are going down Broadway and around the city, putting up these secondary levees throughout the town. And a little bit of the humor from Cindy Freeman Kramer, who took this picture, caution flood ahead, right next to our current river level reading right there. This is near the KOA campground, looking at the highway that continues to suffer from backwater backing up from the Mouse River. This area is pretty indicative of what's going on, trying to protect city lift stations and sanitary sewer systems, building these large ring dikes throughout the area. And this is near Green Thumb from Michelle Tweeton Smith, as the water is overtaking the road. And again, near the KOA campground, some of the heavy trucks moving through the water, trying to get clay out to those needed areas. And these are the folks that have been doing the river level readings throughout Minot. They walk every inch of the dike and take those readings to ensure that we were at a level that was at a time conducive for flood protection. We're back to the National Guards, who are directing some of those heavy equipment trucks to get a faster route through Minot. And this is near Baker's Bridge that has been closed several times, open, closed again, reopened, and it will be closed now for a good amount of time as the Mouse River continues its rise in rampant rage through the entire Mouse River Valley on our way to set records on every reading site in and around our entire area. Brandy Shar submitted this one, at Dyke Walker with the National Guard troops in the background. And then again, this is Highway 15 over County Highway 15. Brandy Shar submitted this one again. We can see the closed road straight ahead as water has just inundated that. This is what we're going to be seeing a lot of, the bypass with traffic jams backing up for hundreds of yards, if not a quarter to half mile at times, and we can plan for a lot longer commutes these days. Colton Avenue in Burlington, as that bridge has been overtaken by water. You can see the dike system on the far end that is trying to keep the Mouse River at bay. KOA Campground, who had set up those dikes months and months and months ago, has just been inundated with water. A very tough sight to see. This is Perry Olson taking out his big screen, trying to get that hauled out of the house well before the
gotta
flood.
Have your priorities.
That's
your
right.
HD set.
Gotta have the HD set.
And you know what? Is this on a loop? Is this going to move, or are they punching the numbers up?
Nope, this is just on a loop.
Okay,
they're
then I'll
automatically
wait.
Moving forward.
I'll wait.
This is some of the big, heavy trucks, again, moving through the highway, trying to get the clay out. And this one's near the Logan Bridge. You can see the water is just right up to the base and has spread out through such an amazing area over there. Near the Souris Valley Golf Course from Michelle Tweeton Smith. Again, a hard sight to see is homes with just water completely through the entire system, and this is where the sandbags busted through the basement window and water came pouring into the basement. The furnace right there taking on water, the water heater then submerged, and the softener there. It's a tough sight to see for anyone to watch their home take on flood water. Never ever a pretty sight, and all of us in Minot are soon to be in that same boat. 27th Street Southwest, water overtaking the road again, a familiar sight the last few days as the Mouse continues its march higher. We have shown this one a couple of times with the indicator of the 1969 flood level. 8 feet higher is where the projected crest is going to be, which will put that water level well into the windows. Miracle Mart once again evacuating their facilities over at Arrowhead, getting all of the food and coolers out in preparation for the flood that is certain to take Minot here sometime today. This is the 3rd Street Bridge in Minot, looking west towards the Broadway Bridge there. 4th Avenue is where that dike is built on. That is the secondary dike that is hopefully going to save some homes in Minot. And refusing to leave, very well could be the case, might be on that rooftop for a very long time. Sherwood here is where the Mouse enters the U.S. This is the Sherwood reading site, not the town of Sherwood, but the Sherwood reading site, where those levels are escalating tremendously. City crews again working on the water treatment plant. And I think out of this, Mike, why don't we just bring up that homepage after this is done not the page, but the camera of the water treatment plant as work is going on. The walking bridge at 6th Street, the old, or actually 8th Street walking bridge there. And then the First International Bank on Central Avenue, as they were sandbagging up in an attempt to hope to keep the mouse water levels at bay, and we'll be checking on that throughout this flood fight. And then looking towards Central Avenue again, as the Mouse River is climbing higher and higher, and less room for the river to run each and every hour. About a foot of freeboard on some of the dikes in Minot, a little more in others, but certainly a fight that we are going to lose. The walking bridge over at Roosevelt Park, water right up at the base of that bridge. And words of encouragement, stay strong, 2011. I think certainly our strengths and our weaknesses are going to be put to the test over the next few weeks. You can see the traffic is still moving on 16th Street Southwest. This is over right next to the water treatment plant. There were some concerns that they were actually closing that off. You can see traffic is still moving. The water is rising and is and continues to threaten the closure of that bridge, but as of right now continues to stay open. And my guess is that city officials and the Corps will attempt to keep that bridge open as long as possible so that we can continue to get people evacuated out of Minot. It is 1 minute after 4 o'clock now, and there is still enough traffic to be considered a busy little street at this hour of the day. Normally it would be pretty vacant at 4:01 in the morning, but earlier in the day when we were showing this webcam, it was a literal steady stream of vehicles that would be backed up for almost a quarter mile on 16th Street. Just an amazing sight.
You know, earlier today when Joe was setting up this this webcam, from KX to that spot took him 45 minutes, and that's normally about a 5-minute drive.
It is just amazing to think about how our lives are going to change, commuting, working, living, any and all of it. We continue to answer questions throughout our Facebook page. One of the questions that a gentleman brought up is, he's saying, can we get some consistency between levels in Minot and Burlington? What's going on? Well, the answer to that is no, we can't give you consistency. Here's what's going on. The readings in Burlington, and this is taken on by the National Weather Service when they set up their readings, and I don't know why it was started that way. The answer that I was given a long time ago was, well, this is how it was done here, and this is why we do it this way.
I actually called about that.
Okay.
Why some of them are small numbers, like 20 feet, and the others 15, 55. This is what the hydrologist at the National Weather Service told me when I asked him a few weeks ago. Whoever installed the gauge got to pick. There's no rhyme, no reason. That's what happened. So if you installed it and you wanted to use 23 feet, you got to use feet. If I installed the gauge and I wanted to do elevation, I can do elevation.
And those feet are metered off of a gauge that's put in the water. It's basically a big stick that's on a large pole or on a bridge that has the feet mark. So in Sawyer or in Burlington, they measure by feet,
right,
off of this stick. And that has nothing to do with elevation. That has nothing. It all depended on who put that marker in the water, and that's how they gauged it. Well, a good number of places around the country, and not to say all of them, it's probably a 50-50 mix, I'm not even sure, but elevation readings can be taken with the GPS. And I think that is why Minot has chosen to use the Broadway Bridge as our official reading, because when they go around Minot and measure those dike levels, they can take those GPS readers and say, okay, this dike is at 1556.
Right.
This one's at 1555.2. We need to raise this one 8 inches. And not to say that it's wrong to use the feet marker like in Sawyer or in Burlington, but that's just how it was.
Yeah,
so I'm sorry, Matt, we're not going to give you any consistency because we can't get any consistency with the readings. I wish we could. It would make life a lot easier one way or another for all of us in understanding the difference between the river levels in Sawyer, because Sawyer is feet, Velva is elevation, Minot is elevation,
but
Burlington is feet.
Northwest of Minot is feet.
Yes. So we can't even gauge northwest of Minot without actually going out there and taking a GPS reading and saying, okay,
Now, we've had quite a few people wondering, how can they tell where their house is at elevation? And there are a couple places you can do it. And
Google Earth is one of them.
Yeah, Earth Tools.
Okay.
Google Earth and Earth Tools. Now, I do want to point out that we've had a lot of people do this in the past couple of days. And to be honest with you, I don't remember which one is which. I think Google Earth has a 6 to 10 foot
disparity.
So it appears that Earth Tools is the more accurate of the two. You can do both, but I know people that know exactly where their house is and it was 6 feet off, somebody else had 10 feet off.
Yeah. And that does create a problem, especially when we're talking about the levels that we're talking about. If you're fighting a matter of a foot or two away from, say, your first story to your second story or basement to your main level, if there's a 6 foot disparity, that is certainly not going to do you any good to try to take that reading and then gauge your evacuation plan on that. Do you evacuate your main floor to your second floor? Do you evacuate everything out of your basement to your main floor? Unless you just have a really good GPS tool and not one of the apps on the cell phones, the apps have a plus or minus 10 feet, so this will do you no good.
I will tell you, however, just to throw another monkey wrench into that theory, my wife works at the Minot Commission on Aging, and they did at her office, I think, the Google Earth.
Okay.
And then there was an engineer that had a good GPS or whatever, and they matched. So
maybe they got lucky.
Could be. So
I'm not gauging my house on any of it. I'm just evacuating all of it. We're going to do a couple of quick announcements, and then maybe we'll take a break here in just a few moments. But one of the questions that was posed some time back is, will the power be shut off before that evacuation? And the people from Verendry had told us that the power will be shut off after the evacuation. So you will have electricity until the evacuation. Now, that does include if the sirens blare, they may just pull the plug then on the power grid. And I don't know all of what that means, but I was told that Xcel Energy can press a couple of buttons from their headquarters and power goes off in the valley.
Now, you know, some of that may have to do with water, because water and electricity aren't really good friends.
Mm-hmm.
And so just because the sirens are going off, if there's no water, can they control it? Let's say zone 3 isn't going to be underwater for an hour.
They're going to kill it all.
They're going to kill it.
Once the sirens go, they're going to shut it down, because once one of the dikes breach, it becomes a domino effect from there. Minot, once it starts flooding, it will flood everywhere. So that's the issue. MDU was going around most of today shutting off natural gas throughout the Souris Mouse River Valley in Minot. That will continue if it already hasn't been completed. Also, Lake Darling is closed. It's fishing to all boat fishing. Boats are being kept off of the lake because of the extreme water flows and hazards because of the high water. And, you know, we'll take at issue with the basements and windows and foundations here after the break. Let's take
a little number here just to throw out, because we've been talking about Facebook all night. 23 hours ago when we left, we were, I think, on Facebook, we had like 9,200 people on Facebook. And as of right now, it's exactly 13,600. So we picked up quite a few people on Facebook. And, you know, we've been getting some great pictures and a lot of good questions off Facebook.
And a lot of good information as well.
Information.
So people are able to answer questions about, for instance, the bridge up by just east of, or not the bridge, but the road up by West Hope that goes across that Mouse River. That is still open. However, Highway 5 going to Botno is closed with barricades there. Some of those questions and answers have...
We're getting a lot of information from you. So please continue to use Facebook. And don't be afraid. You know, when you're out driving, you're evacuating, the radio, if you've been watching on TV and you're waiting until the last minute to unplug it, on the radio, it's WGO 102.9 or 94.9, the zoo. So we're simulcast there.
And you can find us on Facebook by going to facebook.com/KXNewsMinot. We're going to take a short break, send it to CBS for a few minutes, and we will continue our continuous round-the-clock flood coverage on KX News. We'll be back in just a few moments.
From KX News in high definition, this is a special report, Flood Fight 2011.
And good morning. It is 18 minutes past the hour of 4 o'clock. Shaun Sipma in with you for our continual flood coverage, Flood Fight 2011, right here on KX News. Certainly, it is going to be a historic day in Minot. This is the day that Minot will flood, a flood that will last for weeks, according to the National Weather Service and the Corps of Engineers, as they expect these high river flows to last for well more than a week into 2 weeks. And in that, we'll be flowing right through the heart of Minot, through the Souris-Mouse River Valley. Over 10,000 people have now been evacuated throughout the entire valley and outside into Burlington in the subdivisions, all between Burlington and Minot, and then East Side Estates and to the east. Certainly is going to be a very, very hard and tough few weeks, if not months, and maybe even longer for many of us. Now, there was some good news today involving a secondary dike system that could possibly save quite a few homes in Minot. Good news for some and not so good news for others, as Perry Olson explains.
A potential ray of hope at today's press conference, after it actually, for a majority of people living in evacuation zone 5, part of 6, and all of 9. A secondary dike may keep water from reaching that part of the city, a section once considered one of the most vulnerable to flooding weeks ago. A secondary dike built from University Avenue south on 3rd Street Northwest all the way to and under the Broadway Bridge, then shooting east along 4th Avenue, then turning into Railway Avenue, may save these homes and businesses.
Well, the idea is we had the secondary dike started there when we had that first threat, and we tried to build secondary dikes in a number of places around in the city. Those were completed, and now we're adding to them to get up to the elevation that is going to be needed for Broadway to be at 62 or 63. We're just adding to the top of those dikes to get the area protected. By doing this, we'll keep Broadway open, and we'll also keep 3rd Street Northeast open.
If successful, it could potentially save hundreds of homes and some businesses from the flood water. Water, by the way, that appears to be coming sooner. Today, the mayor announced that the mandatory evacuation time that was set for Wednesday at 10 had been moved up to Wednesday at 6 p.m. Rainfall in the Delac Basin, paired with increases from Canada, have the river rising faster, and the potential to top the levees sooner is real. Lake Darling releases actually decreased today to handle more Delac River water, but that will end soon, and the releases will be at 20,000 CFS through the Darling Dam by June 28th. But what happens when water tops the levees, and what if it is before the 6 o'clock deadline on Wednesday? Well, you'll know, and may know moments before it happens, thanks to guard patrols that have been ramped up.
As soon as they see a spot that appears to be imminent, that it's going to go, they are to call Minot Central Dispatch or their supervisors and get that word to Minot Central Dispatch so we can set those sirens off. We're going to do it as quickly as we can.
If that happens, officials say you must stop everything and leave right away, getting to higher ground.
I would encourage everyone, you know, as soon as you go to your home now, to think, you know, what is my quickest route, my quickest evacuation route out of here to high ground. So people need to think about that even before that siren blows. So when the siren blows, they know, you know, where they're going to go and how to get to high ground immediately.
And when water does flow over, it will be a quick rise.
But once a levee is overtopped, there's only more coming behind it. So the best and most prudent reaction would be to sound the alarm and then evacuate the area for life safety.
Hopefully it doesn't reach that point, water spilling over before 6 on Wednesday. But if it does, have your plan ready. In Minot, Perry Olson, KX News.
That plan becoming ready is becoming a very real and vivid thought in many of our minds this morning as we work our way towards into the early morning hours of this Wednesday. We are on our way to 1555.4, currently sitting at 1555.08. 1555.4 is a mile marker in a sense. That was the record crest that was achieved, or crest rather, level achieved during that 1969 flood, that flood that devastated Minot all those years ago, 42 years ago. And then certainly this new crest that we are expecting at 1563 will far surpass the crest that was set back in the 1800s, in 1881. The Mouse had reached a level of 1558, and we are now just 3 feet away from that mark on our way to 1563. Tens of thousands of people are evacuating the city of Minot right now, even at this hour. In Burlington, those evacuation orders go into place at noon. The people in Minot have to be out at least by 6 p.m. tonight. And along with that, many businesses within the Mouse-Souris River Valley, those two were in the process of getting out of the valley. Carla Burbage was there on Tuesday.
With the water rising, businesses are scrambling to get ready for the worst flood we have ever seen. At Tires Only, they are moving 25,000 tires. Located on 4th Avenue Northeast, this is a business that distributes tires to dealerships in a five-state area. Tires Only is setting up in another location so that business can continue. And then over to Harley's Arrowhead Conoco. Owners hired a contractor to enclose the property with a 10 to 12 foot dike. They are taking out inventory too, but are hoping the dike will help save the property. Although all the fuel and the underground tanks should be safe.
If we fill the tanks to full and we seal the top so there's no way water can get in and they won't pop out of the ground then. And the fuel will not be contaminated or the tanks. The state was here yesterday at 3 and they said everything looks great.
And then the marketplace at Arrowhead is moving all its inventory again. They emptied the store earlier this month and then moved it all back. Store officials say this time all machines and electronics must go too because water damage could be horrible. And with this dike outside of Lowe's Printing at 5th Avenue Northwest, just off North Broadway, the city is protecting a nearby lift station. Lowe's Printing will not be saved. So Lowe's is moving what they can now, and by Thursday, house movers are coming to haul out the huge printing machines.
If they're covered with water, it's going to be a lot longer to get them going again.
Lowe's Printing will move the office and continue with the graphics work, but as far as printing, that will have to wait. And nobody knows just how long that will be. In Minot, Carla Burbage, KX News.
Certainly some of these timelines are being stepped up as the Mouse River continues its climb. Evacuation ordered by 6 p.m. on Wednesday. That is tonight, 6 p.m. tonight. We're looking at just making that mark of 12 hours, 13 hours now, and about 13 and a half hours. What we're looking at is the 16th Street Bridge over by the water treatment plant in Southwest Minot. That is one of the bridges that is being threatened by the water as it continues its climb towards the inundation of Minot. And we're seeing that it is a little bit of a delayed, delayed picture there. I'm guessing that's not the picture. There we go. Having a little bit of trouble with freeze up on that, but there were a couple of concerns that they were closing that bridge off already earlier this morning. But as we found out that was not the case, the PD and some of the other folks were actually just stopping traffic and allowing those trucks to move into that water treatment area so they could continue building that dike. You can see a little closer picture there as that water is pushing up against the bridge. You saw a car just passing over the bridge right there. In the forefront is the water treatment plant, and then right behind it, you can see the water right there as the cursor is moving on it. That is the water right there. I don't know if we can switch over to that other webcam that we have to go take a look at 4th Avenue. This might just take a moment here. There it is. It's the Braze cleaners there, and that bright light kind of towards the right center of your screen, that's actually right over in that area of Sammy's Pizza. And the Broadway Bridge right there in the middle of the screen, cutting it in half, where they are currently working on that secondary dike. You can see some of the cars going over the Broadway Bridge right there. Again, that bright light is the area where those that heavy equipment is working to raise up that secondary levee to try to keep Broadway high and dry when the Mouse finally does overcome our levee system later on this afternoon or tonight. So, Tom, right now, we have been watching weather. Weather kind of has been the problematic cause of all of our pains and woes and misery to I guess, for the weeks ahead. But we were looking at some rain showers in the area earlier. Do we have
if we could, Mike, pull up the rain. This is the HD precision radar. And It has the line really hasn't moved a whole lot, maybe a mile or two to the west. It's stretching from central Bottineau County through McHenry County down into Sheridan and extreme eastern McLean County. That line is drifting west a little bit, so you know we still can't write rain completely out of the forecast, but that is slow moving. And you know, yesterday, Shaun, we had, you know, inch and a half into the Lack River Basin. Of course, that goes right into Burlington, and with it, some, you know, that's going to make it into Minot as well, and Logan and every place else. So, you know, no rain is, or, you know, rain west of Minot for this particular purpose only is worse than east of Minot. Now, if you're east of Minot and you've got farmland underwater,
we can't apologize enough for ever saying, gladly it's not falling here. We understand the fact that there is a lot of overland flooding right now and a lot of farm fields not going, that are not going to be planted and crops that need to be sprayed. But I mean, we have never discounted that fact. I just want to make that clear. And I know Tom, you know, you wholly understand that as well.
Yeah, I just feel bad because you make it, I don't want to make it sound like we're glad it's raining on you. I'm only talking about for the purposes of the evacuation in Minot, Logan, you know, whatever's going on in Sawyer, possibly Burlington. Rain would be worst west of Minot than to the east, but at least it's not terribly heavy.
That is true. We can just see that a new reading just slipped up there at 1555.12. That is an increase from the last reading of 0.4.
Yeah,
of
it was
an inch.
0.08. So,
0.08.
And the magic number, the first magic number that we've been kind of talking tonight, is the one that equals the 1969 flood, and that is
1555.4.
So at this, we're probably going to hit this during the midday hours.
Midday hours, and maybe even around that. I would say possibly that 1 o'clock conference call that the USGS, the National Weather Service, the Army Corps of Engineers, Ward County Emergency Management, and city officials all kind of gather together and get the latest information on what the latest predictions are. And what's been interesting, Tom, over the last 72 hours or so, that what a change, what a continual evolution that we've gone through as far as river readings and the future of Minot. We went from being in good shape, comfortable with our dikes, to being immediately discharged with the fact that we are going to lose this flood fight in a very big way because of record rainfalls in Canada that were unforeseen to that point. We've gone into evacuation modes. We were getting set for 1564.4. And then after doing a little more figuring with hydrologists and people from the Corps and things like that, well, we narrowed that down to say, okay, 1563. And I'm curious to see what 1 o'clock brings.
Yeah, because, you know, right now, when we looked at the Sherwood hydrograph, that it was a tremendous uptick in water coming into Sherwood, which is going to make it down
and
here.
And before they adjusted that that prediction, the river level basically took almost a 90 degree arc.
Pretty close to 90 degrees.
It was very close, and the prediction was actually on a gradual increase.
Not quite 45 degrees, but I mean it was a dramatic, and there it is right there. And I know there's a lot of people listening on the radio, and you can't see that, but just kind of picture you lay an L down on its side. That's kind of what the hydrograph looks like. And it wasn't supposed to do that.
Yep.
At least, so we know that there's a tremendous amount of water getting into Sherwood right now. And how will that impact everything else down the Mouse River? And so the hydrologists, the Corps of Engineers, they're going to be crunching numbers this morning. And I'm sure there's going to be some new numbers coming out. And every day the numbers have changed. I mean, we haven't gone 24 hours where something hasn't changed fairly significantly.
And I'm trying to get a closer look here on my screen let me see if I can zoom in. Oh, I'm going the wrong way. And it appears, even on my screen here, that the latest readings is coming into Sherwood is still above what their forecast is. They were looking at, you know, right around that 20,000 CFS, which is just an unimaginable amount of money coming down the amount of flow coming down the Souris, and it's already still outperforming what the prediction is.
Now, I got a note from the National Weather Service saying that they're doing some new numbers based on what's happening in Sherwood, and they Can you check and see if it's been released? I mean, by clicking on the right side of the screen there and get the flows.
Absolutely.
Are those still the old numbers?
These, let's see here, we're looking at the 29th at 26.1 feet. Is that, click on your screen there, because we still have the old numbers logged in.
Or 26.1?
26.1 up in Sherwood.
Oh, this says 26.6.
Now, this only goes out to the 29th?
Well, we have 26, the last number that we had in there was, and then we did this earlier tonight, 26.6 on June 26th.
Okay.
So numbers are changing.
Well, we do have 26.6 on the 20. Reaching that point, 26.4, 26.6, reaching on the 26.
Okay, well, that's what we have there. So, but those numbers may change with all this water coming in. And
absolutely,
that's one of the things they are, the Weather Service, the hydrologists are there, are going to be crunching some numbers here.
And just gauging by the elevation of the spike on this, it has increased just a tremendous amount. It's gone up about 3 feet. Which is a substantial rise in a river when you talk about it that short period of time. One thing that we want to talk a little bit about, Mike, if you have that basement window graphic, we had discussed this early in the evening, discussing about leaving your basement windows open during the evacuation, realizing it's tough for a lot of us to leave our homes and to have any windows open as we leave. But here's kind of the idea behind this, and it's more than an idea, it's actually some sound advice, that the pressure is going to break those basement windows. The amount of water pressure is going to be just unimaginable pushing up against your windows and foundation. And the NDSU Extension Service, and they get their information from experts on flooding, that they really recommend consider removing or opening those windows as that flood is imminent, because it will break them, and then it's going to inundate your basement anyway. Now, that water pressure could possibly damage basement walls that maybe are constructed of that cinder block sort. A lot of those were constructed in the 1930s, 40s, 50s, and even into the 60s and 70s. It's certainly that reinforced concrete is the better of the foundation, so to speak, but you certainly don't want to impede or prevent your basement from flooding. If it's flooding outside, you don't want that amount of pressure pushing against your foundation, because that certainly could compromise it and possibly create a failure in it.
And also remember that after talking with Alan Schlag, the hydrologist from the Weather Service, Jim Olson talked to him earlier today. One of the things that he mentioned was that there would be some kind of a current now, and current through buildings can be destructive. So, you know, the overall river level might be a little bit lower, but if you have a current, that's not good either.
That's not good. One of the comments that we had a concern here on this last little bullet point. Now, if you're fairly certain your basement walls are not going to be able to withstand that that pressure, that initial influx of water, that there is actually suggesting that you flood your own basement. Now, we are being asked to conserve water. If you do decide to flood your own basement before you leave, we had a couple of individuals say, well, get a pump and pump out from either the river or from a drainage area that's holding water, something like that. But we're not encouraging anyone to use the city water to flood your own basement, because like you had mentioned, what's going to happen is we're going to create a flow through this river basin in Minot.
Well, let me ask you, I mean, because you have a house there, could you do that to your own house without getting sick to your stomach?
I don't know. I honestly don't think I could put run a hose into my basement and fill my own house full of water, my own basement. And we had to even discuss that issue if we would have had time of we are three houses from the river, to just stick a big pump in there and pump the basement full. And it would be hard to stomach. Now, it would be really hard to stomach.
Yeah, I don't know how you do that. And also, where's the timing on that? You fill up your basement and you leave. Now you've got all the pressure inside your house trying to get out before the river.
Well, I've got a very solid feeling. We've been down in the valley since 2005. This year is the only year that I've ever seen sump pumps running out of basements. And I've got both the neighbors to the west of me and five neighbors to the east of me, farther away from the river, all have groundwater issues, seepage coming in at a very good clip, because the water table now is so high because the river is running high, well above out of the river channel on the temporary levee system, just because my basement isn't built as deep, I think, is the only reason I don't have seepage. But that tells you that the pressure is already pretty immense with just the groundwater already at that level.
Right.
So, and while we're talking on sump pumps, we might as well just say it again that the folks on the Hill, we cannot stress enough that we have to get those sump pumps out of the sanitary sewer systems. They cannot go in your floor drains. They cannot go into a drain that has been plumbed into the sewer systems. We have to get those out. And that is simple as if you want to close off your house and don't want to have a window open, you can remove the window out of there, and you can go to a Max Hardware or to Minot Lumber over here and buy a piece of plywood or even a finished wood to where you can have it cut for your window size, get a hole cut the size of a drain tube that you would use for a sump pump and run it through there. And once that's out, make sure that you get it out into the street so that that water can drain through the storm sewers and not back into the ground, thus defeating the purpose of getting the water away from the house, because then it's just going to seep back down.
Because what I've been told that part of the problem, and I'm not blaming everybody here, part of the problem is the people that took their hose and ran it into their drain in the basement, no, as opposed to out in the street. I'm not saying everybody did that. I'm not trying to imply everybody did that. But I've been told people did it.
No, there are a lot of people that has been standard practice for a good number of years. I understand in Fargo that there is a substantial fine if you are caught running your sump pump into the sanitary sewer. And actually, Minot does have an ordinance on the books. I've never looked up to see what the fine was, but one of the aldermen told me some while back that it is a pretty substantial fine as well if you're caught. Not that they go around checking everybody. But you had mentioned that's part of the problem. Alan Walter identified it as the majority of the problem. This is what could cause our failure of our lift stations if we don't get it turned around.
Okay.
So I think that's the end of that conversation with as far as what we do need and to take care of. We do have that water, being asked to conserve water through all of Minot, Burlington. I believe that's Berthold and Southwest Water and all of that area that rural water out there as well, because we are in the issue of only having that one aquifer that we are drawing from. As Ellen Walter said, it should be enough to get us through, because a lot of our pumps, our city pumps, are out in that east side of States area, and they're going to be just absolutely inundated with water as this river continues its climb. So being asked to conserve water, and that means just if you have automatic sprinklers, turn them off. Don't even think
and
about
it. And we had a Facebook post here tonight that somebody around the 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock hour last night, according to Facebook, they drove by somebody's house and had the sprinklers on. And some people have automatic, and they might have left and forgot.
Pull the plug. They operate on a power system that... there's a timer that has to turn on. I'd say pull it.
Because I can't imagine with the rain that we've had that you would intentionally water your
yard. And there are also a lot of businesses that they're put on a timer, and that's the way they are. And we just are asked to remind everyone to conserve that water, because it is going to become a different Minot, I'd say, as early as tonight when we watch those levees fail.
Because it begins tonight. According to the numbers that we have.
When we watch those levees fail, life in Minot is going to change substantially tonight. And not looking forward to that aspect, but in the other sense, Jim and I talked a little bit about it on our phone conversation. It really has become an issue of strangers helping neighbors, and I would say a community coming together to help friends and family and even people you don't know to help get everything out of homes, to save what we can, knowing that this unprecedented, unimaginable amount of water is set to just overtake our levee system, flood our homes, and essentially change our way of life.
And this is certainly going to be a body blow. It doesn't have to be a knockout. Because when you look at what's going on with Facebook and people helping, I mean, Jim Olson had strangers, I think, helping him. I think Perry, I don't know if you had people you don't know help, because you've been here doing a lot of stuff as well. We read the stuff on Facebook of people, just strangers, offering daycare, offering trucks, offering Bobcats, heading out to Burlington to sandbag.
Mm-hmm.
This is just, You know, Minot's had a good reputation as a family town, and this really is going to go a long way.
Absolutely. I had actually three people. I don't know if I can't even keep the days straight anymore, actually. I'm on 1 hour of sleep and starting to lose my voice from the sounds of it. 1 hour of sleep in the last 48 hours. But the issue today, I actually went on to Facebook and was just looking for any friends who might not be working today or might have some time over the lunch hour to help me move some big things. So I put it on there, and a bunch of my friends were working, but the friends of my friends who I don't know actually came over and saw that Facebook post and came over. So I had four or five people that I had never met helping me haul stuff out of my house today. And, you know, a couple of them were there for a couple of hours, and a couple others stayed for even longer. And I can't say thank you enough to everybody who's just volunteering your time to help people out.
And that kind of thing is happening all over the city. So, you know, it's going to be tough. Things change today. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we'll make it.
Absolutely. Why don't we take a short break? It is 44 minutes past the hour of 4 o'clock. We're going to send it to CBS News. And we'll be back in just a couple of moments for a continual flood coverage of Flood Fight 2011 right here on KX News.
From KX News in high definition, this is a special report, Flood Fight 2011.
And good morning. It is 5 minutes to the top of the hour of just coming up on the hour of 5 o'clock here. Shaun Sipma in with you along with meteorologist Tom Schrader and a great many other people within our KX News team. Actually, Perry Olson is on the phone with us right now as he was in and around getting some shots of the secondary levee system. Good morning, Perry.
Hey, good morning, Shaun.
So tell me a little bit about what you're seeing out and about this morning.
Well, right now I'm actually driving in the North Dakota State Fairgrounds, but let me just give you the update there first since I'm looking at it. Last night when I left my house for the last time, I live over by the fairgrounds, the diking process had really just started, it appeared, around the grandstand. And now I am driving basically right in between the KX Information Center and the new grandstand. And there is a dike up, and we're talking about 10 feet, maybe 8 to 10 feet all the way around this backside. From what I can tell, you know, they're still working on it. Definitely not complete as of yet. And in fact, actually, as you get toward the north side, there is still work to be done. You can see a lot of the dirt came from the racetrack. We heard the Nodak Race Club basically done now for the year, I believe. I'm right in saying that. A lot of that dirt is coming from then. To the State Fair Center now, and looking, you know, about a 12-foot wall of clay is all around the northeast side. I'm spinning around that south side in between the State Fair Center or the All Seasons Arena or whatever you prefer to call it. It doesn't appear like they are completely done on this side, on the what would be, I guess, the south side. Now, there is clay, but it is substantially lower. Yeah, absolutely, they're not done. We have open spots here. Work continues here, hopefully they can get that work done. I'll go back, Shaun, to the secondary levees now. And I'm on my way back, kind of meandering my way through town here, kind of keeping along the river just to see what I'm seeing so I can pass it on to everyone who's listening. The secondary levee that is being worked on, I stopped at Broadway, just south of Sammy's Pizza, and then made my way over to 3rd, the viaduct there. And the levee, just to give you a grasp of how high it is, it stretches to the very underside of the viaduct. It is extraordinarily high. I mean, it is unbelievable, the height of this secondary levee, designed, of course, as we've talked about now for, well, about 12 hours. So when we were able to put two and two together and kind of realize what this secondary levee could do and perhaps save many, many homes. It is amazing, and I have the pictures. I'm on my way back, and I will lay it down and edit it down for you. It will not take long to edit. I did it in the Jim Olsen style, where I kind of narrated it as I walked, and that really works pretty well because it allows it to be turned around quickly when we get into the newsroom and into the edit bay and start working there. Because I'm over on this side, just driving down in the Green Valley area, I see some folks still here. I see trailers that are still here, a home with a big U-Haul right now with the lights on, and that work obviously continues now as we hit basically 5 o'clock. As I drove over the bridge, and I also see here a National Guard vehicle just stationed in the neighborhood, and that can't tell if there are folks in there. No, they are not. And these guard members are actually here. Let me just talk to them. Guys, I'm live on KXMC right now. Are you guys just walking dikes still? Is that what you're doing?
Yep.
What are you seeing? Things looking pretty good?
As good as it can be, I guess.
As good as it can be, I guess, is what we're hearing. As you are walking the dikes, are you still up on top as you have been, or have you had to?
We tend to stay away from, like, the muddy parts because, you know, we really don't want to hurt ourselves. And then otherwise nobody can walk the dikes, really. So other than that, we're trying to walk on top, just looking for low spots. We kind of come back and check on those frequent spots here and there. So
the process and just these neighborhoods, it seems like it's settled down around here. Is that what you're seeing in these neighborhoods, that the folks have maybe wrapped up for the evening or the morning or whatever we want to call it?
I mean, obviously you can definitely see a lot of people's garbage on the curb, stuff that they're definitely getting rid of because they assume they might lose it, you know. But otherwise, yeah, traffic come to a halt. A lot of houses are empty when we walk by them. So it's kind of a big deal over here, so.
Well, guys, I appreciate the time, and thank you for your work, gentlemen. National Guard members who are walking the dike system, wearing hard hats with lights on top of the hard hats as they do the work here. And as he said, you know, they are still on top of the dikes, keeping an eye on them, and you got the feeling that, you know, there are some spots, yes, that maybe don't look as good as they had, which is understandable with considering, you know, the flows that we're seeing right now. Shaun, it's true we're getting close to 69 levels. Is that true?
We are a little less than 3 inches away from that right now. The current level is at 1555.12.
I'm coming on the 27th, just south of Muse Lumber. As I said, just kind of working my way back to the station, getting closer to a bridge that I go over every morning, headed to work to get ready for start of the news at 6 a.m. So I've been able to have a pretty good, it's kind of been my gauge every morning as I drive by. I'm driving on it now. And, yeah, obviously you can tell that it is higher than it has been. On the south side, as if I'm driving toward Sun Prairie Grain, there is a sandbag dike that's taking care of a little low spot right here. Folks who've driven by probably know what I'm talking about. And the water is starting to inch ever closer toward the top. And, you know, as you might expect, when you look at the river number, you certainly understand exactly, you know, that it's at its highest point, and I can tell that's the case, seeing that river reaching a point I had never seen before. Driving now towards Sun Prairie Grain, this entire area ready to be inundated with water. To my left right now, Robindale Trailer Park, and now here I'm seeing Holiday Village. And I see a couple of mobile home units jacked up, lifted into the air, couple feet. I think I see a spot here, and I'm not going to drive in there right now, although I don't see a whole lot of activity, so maybe I could. But I want to get this video back and get it on air. It looks like I see a couple of spots where perhaps the mobile homes themselves have been taken out. I'm driving on 27th right now, as I said, in between Sun Prairie Green and the Holiday Park, Holiday Village, let me get that right. I believe there is a Holiday Park as well, but this is Holiday Village. And the water is high on this road on 27th in two spots, right at Sun Prairie Green. And now I am at the new Pet Resort and Salon, if you remember that, down where the road starts to curve and head up toward the new overpass. Water pretty deep here now, it appears, stretching over 27th. I'm going about 5 miles an hour as I go through it right now. I see dike work to my right as well around the TLC resort type area, this pet resort and other businesses there as well.
How is the traffic at this time of the hour there, Perry?
Very little. Very little, Sean. Which is obviously good, and you might expect it at 5 o'clock. To tell you the truth, though, I expected to see a lot more, being that, you know, we're getting closer to the time when all this needs to end. You know, we're, what, less than 13 hours away from when it has to be done, and we hope and pray, obviously, that everyone has that entire 13-hour time frame to get this work done. The mayor came on just right before I turned the chair over to you last night, Sean,
at 9:30, yes.
Yeah, about 9:30, the mayor called and indicated that he'd like to go on and, as he said, speak to the citizens of Minot, and he did that, just kind of urging them, saying, you know, we had some rain on the way. He was a little concerned about that, and obviously understanding the work that citizens are doing, and, you know, that 6 o'clock time that had been, you know, already cut back from the 10 o'clock time as they watched the river come up a little faster, as the Delac really became the problem there. Really kind of saying to people, you know, I don't want to alarm anybody or anything like that, but, you know, work through the night if you can. Don't put this work off till Wednesday. If you can keep working right now, do so. And, Sean, I didn't know what to expect when I went to bed. When I laid down about, it was probably 12:30 this morning, I didn't know if I would be awakened to sirens, if we'd be in a good shape still. I really had no idea. I had no feel as to what was going to happen. And when my Taylor Swift ringtone woke me up,
you're admitting that on air too.
Oh, heck, everybody makes fun of me for it. That's fine. There was some relief. I was like, good, people are having this time. I have a swing set I'd still like to get out of my house type thing. So, you know, maybe there's still that chance later today. And obviously it's not the end of the world if I don't get that out. I've got most everything else. Hopefully this means, you know, people can still work hard here today, and we won't hear the siren system go off. And Sean, I'll quit yapping now. Sorry about this. I'm back on the bypass, getting closer to the station. So I'll turn around this video as soon as I can. Unless, do you have any other questions here?
No, actually, we're just looking at some of the video that we're talking over here, looking at the Broadway Bridge over towards 4th Avenue by Sammy's, where some of those secondary dikes are going up. We're actually starting to see some of those large trucks carrying clay on this side. It would be on the north side of the river, so it looks like they're actually putting some of that clay into place and things like that. So
yeah, I did see that. I didn't get over to that side. I'm not sure if – I thought I saw some work on the north side being done perhaps privately around, I believe there's a railroad facility there.
It's Burlington Northern's kind of a training ground for crews, and my guess, looking at this video, is that they are making an attempt to protect that facility as well. There's a pretty good line of trucks steady through there.
I think that's what it is. Don't quote me on this, folks, but I believe that's what that was. This work continues, and when I started shooting here half an hour ago, you know, it was pretty dark, and you know, it being summer now, I believe what our days are now officially getting shorter.
Don't even say that. That's depressing.
But it's getting pretty light out here. Just a few minutes past five. But Shaun, I hope that the pictures that I'll turn around here, hopefully within the next 15 minutes or 20 minutes, I hope people can understand the height of this secondary levee. It really illustrates to me what the city is preparing for. It is incredible. It is amazing how high up in the air these trucks, these bobcats, these skid steers are working. Thankfully, the work continues here as we hit 5 o'clock. And I'm pulling up on the good old KX studio here, Shaun. So
all right, well, we'll look for that video very shortly then from you.
Okay, sounds good.
Hey, all right, sounds good.
That is Perry Olson that we're talking with live as he's actually just getting back to the studio from shooting some of that video from the secondary dikes that are being constructed in and around Minot. As we mentioned, that some of those dikes are being put around city infrastructure, the lift stations, the water treatment plant, as we saw on that one live streaming video. As the sun is just getting set to crest out in the sky, out in the eastern sky here in a little bit, but this will be the first opportunity we've seen the sun, right, Tom, in the last, I don't know, 2 days?
It's been pretty cloudy,
yeah. And actually, that's been a good thing. Mike, if you want to throw up the radar again, as you did while Perry was talking here, there is a little band of rain off to the east of Minot, stretching through central Bottineau County, McHenry County, down into eastern McLean County, part of Sheridan County. And you know, we certainly don't need any more rain. And yesterday especially, you know, sunshine would have been a really big problem because so much moisture in the air would have made things a little more unstable, and thunderstorms would have developed like they did in Montana. And yesterday in Montana, there were some small thunderstorms that triggered flood warnings. That's just how much moisture is in the air. So, I mean, it's nice to have some sunshine early in the day. That's not a big issue, but, you know, we get completely sunny from 1 until 5. We've got storms coming in, and we don't need that.
No, absolutely not. We've certainly had our fill of rain over the past, 2 months, I think, is what we're going with at this. Looking at some of the latest hydraulic predictions from the National Weather Service, and this was pointed out earlier, Tom, and I just want to bring it up again as we are looking at the Souris River near Sherwood. That would be the reading up where the Moss River enters the United States. And all night that we've seen that river has jumped at an 80-degree angle, almost completely vertical, well past what was the earlier predictions from the National Weather Service. They had a nice, even sloping arc heading towards that 26.6 feet, or roughly almost 28,000 cubic feet of water per second. And right now, it is already sitting at 26.15 feet. And we actually, if we were to click on one of those little buttons, we can see that it is projected to hit that 27,900 cubic feet of water per second on the 26.6. Well, it's already at 26.15, and I'm curious to see if they decide to revise that and what that will mean for the Darling Reservoir.
Yeah, I think they've already sent us a note that they are going to be re-crunching the numbers based on this, because there's a tremendous amount of water. And for those of you listening on WGO Radio or the Zoo, and you can't see this, just imagine laying an L down. So you've got that horizontal line, which was the river flow, and all of a sudden it takes nearly a 90-degree turn vertically. And so it can't possibly all of a sudden go horizontal again.
And this certainly could create, in my opinion, a very big issue with the releases that are coming on Lake Darling. They have already released that they're expecting to be releasing 20,000 cubic feet of water per second by June 28th. Now, is this amount of water inflowing going to surpass those expectations? Is that going to drastically alter their perception on what's going on, or is this built in? Or were they planning on that rain?
We got a note. We have a chat room set up with the National Weather Service, and they sent a note a little while ago saying that based on what's happening at Sherwood, there are going to be new numbers. So
okay.
we know that that's going to happen.
Yeah, and like we talked about earlier, that it's really no surprise to see that those numbers change every day, good, bad, or indifferent, simply because we have water flows to take into effect in such a large area. I want to reach up here, and I don't know, I'm not sure if you can actually even see all this.
Tell you what, I'm gonna
really
get the camera
well.
Here.
Grab the camera, and I want to take a look at the watershed from the Mouse Souris River basin here. As John is coming
John's
in to take a look
it.
At this, I just want to have you take a look. And all of this area within this white right in here all flows into the Mouse River. It's starting in Canada and then flows, let's see if I can get it tilted so we don't have a glare. There we go. That area in white is the area that actually is the entire inflow into the Mouse River that flows through Minot. So if it rains all the way to the northwest like it has in record rain amounts, we get it. Burlington gets it. Sawyer gets it. And then it heads back up into Canada. That's pretty good, John. You can zoom out from that point. But it really is kind of an amazing feat to try to factor in what all is involved with trying to figure out the flows. I mean, if you catch 3 inches in one section, a quarter inch over here, a half section up here, okay, how quick is it going to get to these reservoirs that are already full or at near capacity as it is? And then trying to figure in the uncharted flows that's coming in below the dams.
Well,
so,
what about the Dulac? I mean,
that's a whole nother wild card to figure into the mix. And I guess I haven't even looked at the Dulac here in the last 20 minutes. Going back to the hydraulic prediction website from the National Weather Service, it looks as though it is reaching that area where it is going to start on its decline at that 17.26 feet. It was on a good 70 degree climb for quite a while, heading towards that moderate flood stage, and is now looking like it's leveling off.
Yeah.
And the one thing about the Dulac that once it starts leveling off, and unless we get more rain, it normally levels off and then falls fairly quickly unless there's more rain up behind it, which we haven't had a substantial amount of rain in the past 24 hours.
Well, not in 24 hours. Now, yesterday, what day is today?
Today is Wednesday, believe it or not.
Okay, so this would have been
We started
Monday.
Working Tuesday, now it's Wednesday.
Okay, this would have been Monday. There was an inch and a half, and it rose very quickly. So if it falls just as quickly, that would certainly be good news, because there's nothing to stop that rain in the Dulac River Basin from getting into Burlington.
Now, when we talk about these flows that are added in, we're not talking 10,000 CFS the way the Darling is ramping up to 20,000 on the 28th. Right now at 17.26 feet on the Dulac River, that does have a different flow, so we are looking at 2,000, just a smidgen over 2,000 cubic feet of water per second. That's why Lake Darling ramped down to 8,000, so we could get right around that 10,000 mark for a day to try to get us enough time to evacuate, so that when that water starts slamming in from Canada, that's when they're really going to start ramping it up.
And I mean, there are a lot of things that we don't know, because this is the first time this has ever happened to this degree. There are no charts, there are no computer graphs or models. This is the first time. They're kind of going, writing the book as we go. But one thing we do know is the water is arriving in Sherwood right now, and has been for several hours.
And sadly enough, the other thing that we know, that today is the day that Minot floods.
At some point right now, I mean, based on the numbers we've had overnight, roughly 7 o'clock tonight. Could be earlier, could be later, and that's without any structural damage, any levees being compromised. We're talking about a best case scenario using the numbers we have. It's going to be roughly 7 o'clock tonight.
The picture we're looking at is the 16th Street Bridge. This is the one we showed you video earlier today, but I'd like to stay on this. This is live streaming video from our webcam that is just up on the upper part of the water treatment plant. You can see just the massive amounts of water that are pouring. And it almost even looks like onto the bridge. We've got to keep that zoomed in there. Water is actually going onto the 16th Street Bridge at this point. And the farther we zoom in, it's going to pixelate a little bit, but we're fine with that. Let's keep it right there. Water is actually going onto the bridge right now. And we're sending Eric Manlove out the door right now to get some video of this. And let's stay on this picture for quite some time here. You can see the water as it's really streaming onto the bridge right now. It's kind of overtaking 3 or 4 minutes for yours. Perry, take a look right here. This is the 16th Street Bridge as some of the water is starting to cascade on. Like Mayor Kurt Zimmelman said, we knew this was going to happen. We knew that we were going to lose these bridges at some point today, and we're going to try to keep them open as long as possible simply because this is a main thoroughfare here that is that north-south route, and you can see some of the cars swerving to the middle of the road. The water, it doesn't look like it's entirely over the road, but at this point, it looks like it's well coming up into that into the right lane on the northbound side as the water is cascading down. It looks like the car has actually stopped just after going over the bridge. I'm not sure if that's just the traffic light that's backing them up or not, but hopefully we can get Eric Manlove down there and get some updated pictures as it almost looks like little surges, little waves coming onto the roadway.
We have a new number for Broadway, and I'm changing it right now. It's 0.17. It's gone from 0.12 to 0.17.
Okay, so there is our new number that continues to bump higher and higher and closer to that 1969 level. Let's go back to that shot once again here. You can see some of the vehicles that are avoiding the water that's coming onto the road now. I'm guessing it's only going to be a matter of time now until this bridge is closed and that the National Guard or that the Minot Police Department comes in and either closes it down because what would you say, Tom, that we're gaining in river elevation per hour? Is it 0.4 inches? Is it 0.2 inches?
I don't have an answer to that. I'm sorry.
It's kind of been ranging between that 0.2 inch and 0.4 inch.
I think we're closer to average of 0.4 inch.
Okay. So
at least overnight.
Another hour and we could see water flowing easily over the top of that road, if not sooner. That certainly is one of the areas of contention for a lot of folks, and including myself. That is one of the access areas that heading down into my area along 4th Avenue. You can see the cars going over the bridge right there. Well, why don't we take a short break? It is 21 minutes past the hour, 5 o'clock, inching our way towards that 6 o'clock hour when Perry Olson and Joe Goldaddy will be taking over for Tom Schrader and myself.
And actually, Joe's going to be coming in a little bit sooner than 6 o'clock. I'm going to go try to catch a couple of Z's.
You're going to try to get some sleep finally?
Yeah. I'm going to weenie out here on you.
You can't get one more an hour of sleep and just go off that for 48 hours? Come on. Actually, I'm probably not that far behind you.
But so. See, I'm older than you. I need my rest.
I'm not going to argue with that one. Okay, so 21 minutes past the hour. We're going to take a short break here on our continuous coverage of Flood Fight 2011 live here on KX News. We'll be back in just a moment.